Memorial Stadium, sold out in Columbia, South Carolina. The Gamecocks, ranked number 11, welcome the undefeated, eighth-ranked Kentucky Wildcats. Two programs that have tried to challenge the power axis in the SEC East of Florida, Georgia, and Tennessee in a crucial game tonight. Rich Brooks trying to get to 6-0. That has not been done at Kentucky since a guy named Paul Bryant coached the Cats back in 1950, went on to an SEC title. It's been a long time getting to 6-0.
It's been a long time, but his experience is really going to help him prepare for this game, as is Spurrier. Spurrier knows he's got a chance to jump into the top 10. Needs Smelly to play well at quarterback, though.
And he's never lost to Kentucky. 2-0 here at South Carolina, and he owned the Wildcats, punished them in his years at Florida. Talked about the soggy weather, thunderstorms throughout the night. Kentucky has not played a football game in rain, and really, because of drought conditions in the Commonwealth, hasn't hardly practiced at all in rain. The Gamecocks dealt with very soggy tropical depression conditions already this year in Baton Rouge. The first time that these two, quote, second-tier programs in the SEC have ever met when both are ranked. And Kentucky to kick it away. Tim Maste, very good. Often reaches the end zone despite the new kickoff rules from the 30. It is Chris Culliver, the freshman, in the end zone, bringing it out. He's got plenty of speed, Culliver, but he stopped short of the 20-yard line. And the former Gamecock, Deuce Staley, gives you the Monster.com starting lineup for the offense.
I am a Gamecock for life. Tonight, I'm introducing the offensive line, Justin Sorensen, 6'7", 325, a mammoth human being. At wide receiver, Kenny McKinley, a big play receiver who can catch and run with the ball. Let's move along with the running backs. You know I love running backs. Corey Boyd, Mike Davis, Thunder, and Lightning. I love them both.
Deuce knows good running backs, but both Boyd and Mike Davis a little bit nicked up tonight. We'll keep a close eye on their condition. It's Boyd behind Chris Smelly. Moves into the shotgun on the first snap. And this is an inauspicious start. Mr. James, a timeout before the first snap.
Well, you know, South Carolina, that's their first time out of the
half. Sometimes you just got a week didn't get you ready for it. It's early. It's a short week, Chris.
I guess it's better than a turnover in the first play when the rain is falling. The ball coach will have a little conference with his young quarterback. We'll come on back after this. Let's try this again. It took 4 seconds for Spurrier to get agitated as his redshirt freshman Chris Smelly calls a timeout before the first snap. Cats fans down in that corner making some noise. And the basic handoff, and it's Boyd. He's dropped for a drop loss. Flying in there on the stop, and Wesley Woodyard introduces you to the Cats defense.
He's coming off the ball hard, fast, causing a lot of pressure. Moving to the linebackers, we got Bryson Boot Kelly, Smash Mouth guy from LaGrange High School. Moving on to the secondary, it's so hard to name just one guy, but look out for Tavar Lindley and Marcus McClain. Those are big-time playmakers and make a lot of plays.
Keep an eye on Woodyard, number 2 in the SEC, in tackles last season with 122. Smelly, back to throw on 2nd and long. Shows a little escapability, but he'll fight to get back to the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, a little uncertain there. He didn't want to make a mistake early. He didn't have anything wide open. Looked down to his check down. The linebacker was hanging right there. He just tucked it under his arm. He does have great feet. He can move around and buy himself some time.
But the reason he's playing is he's supposed to get rid of the ball. Spurrier wants him to get rid of it. He doesn't want a mistake down here in the red zone. There's no question about that, but he's got to get rid of the football and not take sacks.
3rd and 13 at their own 16. Jared Cook, the tight end in the slot. Kenny McKinley, number 11, is their key receiver. It's caught by Freddie Brown. He's got first down yardage across the 30. Nice pressure completion for the freshman, 15 yards when they needed it.
When you talk about timing, the offensive line's not great up front, is it, Doug? So you have to throw on time with the ball.
Oh, he throws this ball well before the break. Set that back foot. The ball is out. The receiver turns around, and it's right on his chest. Great timing there. And then, like you said, the offensive line doesn't have to hold their block as long.
Let's see if some of the other receivers besides McKinley can make some plays for this offense. They've been slow to come along this season. Deep handoff. This is Mike Davis in the game, tripped up as he gets to the 35. Check it's Boyd on the carry. We haven't seen Davis yet, who had a deep thigh bruise. It's Boyd who had a knee sprain in the Mississippi State game. And on a short week, the health of both running backs is a concern.
But they have two good running backs. They have depth there, and they will try to run the ball. Before the game, we had a heavy downpour, a lot of rain, Doug. So you know the traction out there. They're all trying to get used to it.
It's a positive play on first down, 4 yards for Boyd. And McKinley comes across in motion. McKinley runs a slant, but Simele wants to go downfield looking for Deion McCorn, the freshman. Marcus McClinton, the free safety in coverage, the third down play coming up. They were very strong on third down against Mississippi State. You saw the stats for Smelly, a little bit deceiving. We watched the tape. McKinley made him look good by catching some balls that were not perfectly thrown and then making guys miss. But they were very effective against the Bulldogs' athletic defensive front, 9 of 18 on third down. And we got third and six here. Boyd is the lone setback. That's fake pressure, don't bring it, and it's a draw. Boyd has a block. Corey Boyd across midfield, and another first down. Nice block by McKinley, the receiver, to spring him.
This is a big offensive line that'll lean on you, and you're going to see that there's a big gap here. They love to run draws, and as long as Kentucky is going to play that basic, you're going to have the gaps in there.
It was a cover two. It was a defense set up to stop a pass, and the middle linebacker's trying to get good depth, which allowed it to be easy for the offensive line to get up on their blocks into the linebacker level.
So the Cats look and pass. Spurrier crosses them up. Boyd still the tailback. Short throw, looking for McKinley, well covered. Good job on the edge by Trevor Lindley.
Little press coverage out on the outside, got his hands on McKinley pretty good there, slowed him down coming off the ball.
We'll see 32 on Lindley a lot. He's a cover corner they think has a chance to be special. And if you want to stop the passing game of the Gamecocks, you have to keep a close eye on McKinley. 27 catches coming in, and no other receiver in this team had more than 7.
But you hit on it, too. His yards after the catch are really impressive.
Smelly fires back, has a completion. And it's Wesley Saunders, the young tight end, rumbling toward the end zone. Loses the football as he's going to the goal line. It's fumbled out of the end zone. A touchback and a huge mistake for the tight end Saunders, who was headed for the house. Wow.
Just wrapped the ball up and get in the end zone. You could see it coming when the defender's running from behind and punches it out. It wasn't a matter of him reaching out with the ball or anything like that. He just had it tucked under his arm and running. But boy, you got to protect that ball and feel the guy coming from behind.
Oh, first of all, Saunders is a freshman, a big player, comes out, gets in the flat. Smelly finds him. He's down the field. Now, with experience, you're going to know that people come in traffic from behind you. You got to tuck the football. You got to hold on to it when the safeties come around you.
You want to pull that ball in front of your body to protect it when people come from behind.
It did come out before he got to the goal line. Here's a touchback. I mean, that's
a great job by Trevard Lindley to chase him down and punch that ball loose.
Well, there was no way he was going to bring him down before he got to the goal line. It was his only chance to make a play.
Review it to see if perhaps Saunders crossed the goal line before the ball was punched free. You're shaking your head,
Craig. I don't think so.
Yeah, that ball was out.
It's going to be tough to tell where from this angle, but you can see the great play by Lindley. Never gave up on it.
And as much as players see it happening around the country on highlights throughout the weekend, you have to know that when you get around that goal line, balls are getting knocked out left and right.
The ball clearly out there.
Definitely out. You and I have seen it happen for 25 years. These kids are young, and they've seen it for maybe a year or half a season or two seasons. The coaches have to just beat it into their heads to protect the football.
It was a 48-yard gain. They'll file away that ball play for future use.
After review, video evidence confirms the call on the field. The ball was a fumble, went through the end zone, is a touchback. It'll be first and 10.
So, promising start for the South Carolina offense, but it ends with nothing.
It was a great design on the play. They crossed everyone and slipped the tight end across underneath, going back out the back door. Beautiful play, executed perfectly.
That's all right. Now we get a chance to see the Heisman candidate go at it, huh?
Here's Andre Woodson, the senior. Raphael Little is the talented tailback. And he'll get the first call. And good pursuit by the Gamecock defense. Keenan Burton, the receiver, introduces you to his offensive teammates, the Monster.com lineups.
Now we're going to start with the offensive lineman. At left tackle, we have Gary Big Snacks Williams, which was the offensive lineman of the week in the SEC. At tight end, we have Jacob Touchdown Tammy. Outside, we have Dickie Shake and Bake Lines. At running back, we have Mr. Dead Leg himself, Raphael Little. And, of course, the quarterback, we have Andre Woodson.
And Woodson for his first pass attempt of the night, pressured, loses the football. Scoop and score for the Gamecocks. Tight end. It's redemption. Eric Norwood, we talked about him in the open. That athletic pass rusher there to pressure Woodson. These guys haven't practiced in the rain at all this year, and he coughs it up.
And nobody, it out twice.
And nobody ever gets to Woodson. You know, there's pressure there. He's got to get rid of the football as well. And you could just tell South Carolina couldn't wait to get in the backfield.
And the junior Ryan Suckup on for the conversion. So a wet and wild start. Couple of turnovers here on a soggy night in Columbia. And Norwood makes the big play.
We met with Eric the other day, and boy, he was focused. Boy, he was locked. He was ready to play the game 2 days ago, this kid. Great athleticism. You know, he was the fortunate one that got on the ball. The hit came earlier, but great pressure.
83 Cliff Matthews is a freshman. The young man was a defensive lineman and was moved to linebacker just last week against LSU. This guy has got a lot of desire and athleticism. And it's a challenge. Rich Brooks on the road. You get a chance to recover it and get the touchback, and Matthews just in the backfield.
Yeah, he was Norwood's backup. And they move positions to get the best 11 on the field. They said, we want our best athletes on the field to make plays, paying dividends.
Now, Norwood is the guy, even though he's a sophomore, that gathered this defense around when Jasper Brinkley, the leader, went down with a season-ending knee injury. Norwood challenged guys and said, listen, we need to raise the level of our play. This is a team that's going to have to win with some defense. And Norwood leading by example with the recovery. Chris Fowler, Craig James, Doug Flutie, Aaron Andrews down there in the rain. This crucial but unlikely collision early in October between two top 11 ranked teams.
You know, looking at Woodson on tape, he's had plenty of time to throw the football. And maybe there's a false sense of security there that he's taken a little too long and stepping up in the pocket. And early on, obviously South Carolina got the pressure.
On the kick return, Keenan Burton stopped short of the 30-yard line. So Woodson, who doesn't get rattled, he's known for his poise and his calm. He's matured so much in his career at Kentucky. Didn't have success, was a quarterback of a very bad offense early in his career. Got discouraged. But boy, as he turned around his career and turned around Kentucky's offensive fortunes, he won't be undone by this. But they got to figure out a way to block number 40 quickly. Little is the lone setback. He gets the call, has a crease. Raphael Little, just like that, bursting into South Carolina territory. We talked about both defenses struggling to stop the run. 24-yard gain as Deuce is back to introduce you to the Gamecock defense.
Now you're looking at a stingy pass defense, starting on the defensive line. Eric Norwood, a guy who lives in the backfield, moving along to the linebackers. We have a true freshman at linebacker, Cliff Matthews. I tell you, he reminds me of John Abraham. Moving along to the secondary, it was run by their captain, Captain Munnerman. He'll be all over the receivers tonight. Let's go deep.
All right, Deuce, captain's number one. You'll see Cliff Matthews, the talented true freshman, number 83, and barging into the backfield there for another big play. Is Rodney Paulk, the linebacker. Deuce knows Norwood can play. He knows who the stars are of this defense.
He picked the right guys out to accent, didn't he?
How about our meetings? And Aaron Andrews was amazed at the intensity and focus of Norwood. He was like, man, are you always this serious?
He was locked in. No one could get him to break a smile, laugh, anything. He was ready to play.
Norwood had an enormous play against Mississippi State last Saturday. They were trailing the Bulldogs. He barged in, blocked a punt to turn that game around. Second and 11. They'll run it up in there. Nothing doing for Little. Little or nothing. Aaron, what about Norwood's intensity?
Well, first of all, let's start with their defensive coordinator, Tyrone Nix, who it all stems from. Tyrone is a guy that likes to be on the sidelines. Why? Because he wants to see the intensity in his young defensive players' eyes. And he said, if he doesn't like it, you're not playing. He looks at their eyes before the game. And let me tell you, when they were just over here on the sidelines, he was looking at all of their eyes, including Eric Norwood, which, by the way, before the game ran right into me and said, excuse me, I have to play a game. He was ready to be.
Tyrone wants no part of the press box. He likes being on the sidelines. Ron Cooper assists him from the press box as the defense tries to shut down the Cats on third and 10. Little gets the ball, gets down near the 41. He'll be short of a first down. And a decision for Brooks here. Cook and Jonathan Williams combine on the stop. It'll be fourth and about three, and on comes the punt team.
And carrying on a little bit on that Coach Nix part, he said he has one word that he has for all the players, and there's like an engine word, right?
Kind of a motivating word, something to light a fire.
Yeah. He said so many guys are like, man, you need a notepad just to remember what your word is for each guy.
He knows.
Tim Maste in the punt. He's got a very strong leg, but this time he'll just try to pooch it down in there. Munnerlin, the corner, is the punt returner. Had a punt return for a touchdown called back on a bad flag a week ago against the Bulldogs. And Maste does pooch it down in there. Good coverage. Right up the center of the field and down at the 5-yard line. And that's where the Gamecocks will start. A defensive touchdown. The only points so far tonight. These games are a sellout. He doesn't want any no-shows. Second possession. It's Boyd for a hard-earned 4 yards. A 79-yard march, which ended with the fumble by Saunders in the first possession. Saunders fumbling the ball just a few feet from the goal line. Good job by Trevard Lindley to punch it loose. But Gamecock defense got the ball right back. Fumble force against Woodson. Look at the athletic play. The scoop and score by Norwood. 44 seconds separating those two turnovers. They're playing it very safe down here. Another run right into the boundary. He'll set up a third and about six.
Back-to-back power football there, going downhill, running the power O play, trying to get it out of their own end. You're going to put it in your quarterbacks here on third down, the freshman deep in his own end here.
But at this point here, and your defense playing like they are, why make a mistake? You know, it's one of those deals. Do not make a mistake down here. Let your defense keep playing ball.
Is this a special teams and defense game?
I bet it isn't before it's over.
These are two struggling defenses coming into the game. Jerry Cook, the sophomore tight end in the slot. McKinley will motion out. That was called from the sidelines. McKinley at the top of the formation now. Spurrier will do that. He wanted to get McKinley in a matchup, but they were all over it. Well covered. Ventrell Jenkins, the defensive tackle, on the pressure.
He'll make that call, Spurrier will, from the sideline, trying to get the matchup that he wants so McKinley can get the football. And the guy can run with it when he catches it. McKinley is an excellent football player and wanted the ball.
McKinley ran a little bubble, and he was trying to get, we had seen that on film, that he caught that little bubble pass, but it was press coverage, so he must convert this route. Here's where they shifted him. They moved him inside, and you got to read the coverage. If it's press coverage, you got to take off on the face.
You could read Spurrier's lips. What did you see? He asked McKinley when he came off, because it wasn't the same thing that he saw from the sidelines. On the punt. It's high and very short. Fair catch made by Little and great field position. The Cats will set up at the 43-yard line of South Carolina. So far, the high-powered offense has been contained. Kentucky offense that's got a minimum of 435 yards in their game so far this season, held to just 11 yards in the first two possessions. They'll run it to Little. Left side has some blockers, has the corner, a short gain at the 40. Carlos Thomas, and now the flag comes in. Looks like they got the face mask.
Flag.
Little part of the package here. It's not just Woodson. He's a very effective running back. 547 yards. Averages almost 7 yards a carry.
Personal foul. Face mask. Number 5 on the defense. 15 yards from the end of the run. Automatic first down.
It is on Carlos Thomas. Well, Saturday night, a couple of unbeaten ranked Big Ten teams meet. The Buckeyes take on the Boilermakers. Pac-10 markets and some in Indiana. We'll see Notre Dame visiting UCLA, which is also available on ESPN Game Plan. Saturday night, college football presented by Southwest Airlines on ABC at 8 Eastern. Penalty moves the ball all the way to the 16-yard line. And Woodson looks down the middle, has a man, and down inside the 10-yard line is Jacob Tammy, the tight end. Tammy is 18th catch of the season. He's a weapon.
Give Woodson time. He's going to find his receivers. He really likes his tight ends in this offense, and he's able to find him and look across the field, Doug.
He had a post route on the backside clearing out. The tight end goes down, just runs an in route across the field. Actually, they were fortunate that the captain came off and made the tackle there because he left his man to make the tackle. Otherwise, it's a touchdown.
One of them helping out, and now it's first and goal. Woodson swings it in the flat, but he overled John Connor, and the fullback stumbles. Marvin Sapp was there to pressure him.
This is a really efficient red zone offense. When they get out here, they score touchdowns, and they love the fullback. A couple of receiving touchdowns by Connor this year. So it really adds pressure to that defense about covering numbers of players.
And as the graphic showed, Woodson has not thrown interceptions, and last week, finally, his first one after trailing 25 attempts.
And he blamed the fullback on that one. So the fullback there.
It's never quarterback's fault.
Second and goal. Little. Nowhere to go. Diving in there was Marvin Sapp. He is the second cousin to ex-Hurricane great Warren Sapp.
Well, to give you an idea about their success in the red zone, they call it the blue zone in Kentucky. 23 out of 24 trips in there, they've scored points. 20 touchdowns.
Yep.
And, you know, 12 of those were by rush. So they do like, even though they have Woodson, they like to run it.
It tells you a team is running the ball well. When they score that many touchdowns, it's the most efficient way to get it into the end zone. Woodson gets all the hype about his arm and the passes and the touchdowns, but they run the ball well.
They'll throw it now.
Woodson has room over the middle. He threw high and was looking for Little off his hands, and he wasn't going to get a touchdown anyway. Thought he had a chance maybe with his feet to get near the end zone there.
But he doesn't like to run. He's not one of those quarterbacks. He can, but he's not wanting to leave the pocket running.
Yeah, he's the type of guy who can move around, buy himself some time. If he has to take off for a few yards, he'll do that. He's not the explosive guy.
Coach, it's third and goal.
Get it in the end. Hey, you don't have to convince me. I'll run anytime.
So, in other words, you'd be the coach. That's what the quarterback coach would tell him tomorrow in game film.
Sieber is a very accurate kicker inside of 40 yards, and this is just from 27. Knocks it through. But given the field position that Brooks' team started with, the 43-yard line of the Gamecocks, that's a win for the South Carolina defense.
You know, if this is an intense environment, it's a big game, national TV Thursday night. Aaron, I'd be interested to see and hear from you what Woodson is doing on the bench. What's his demeanor like?
Well, his demeanor right now is he's over here talking to his receivers. Before he came out in that series, he went over to the coach and said, I don't like what I see. I want to start running it a little more. Right now, he's talking back and forth to the quarterback's coach a bit. They're discussing what they're seeing. He's very up right now. You know, his demeanor really hasn't changed since the beginning of the game, Craig.
Aaron, that's Randy Sanders. He credits him so much with his development as a quarterback. Sanders, of course, years at Tennessee, worked with Peyton Manning and T. Martin, and yeah, they didn't see eye to eye at first, coach and player, but they do now.
Yeah, Andre said it took him a while to buy in, and you build that trust. Once you build the trust, then you buy into what you're being told, and you advance, and you learn, and you move forward in your development as a quarterback.
Discussing what they saw down there in the goal line.
Well, it was funny last week. He threw his first pick last week. It was a red zone pick, and it was when the game was out of reach. And all of a sudden, all of a sudden, the place went to their feet. The entire hometown crowd, they realized what he had accomplished. 325 attempts, no interceptions. They go to their feet. I've never seen anyone go to a standing ovation on an interception.
You don't even know your longest streak without an interception, right?
I said about 100. I know I went two or three games, at least three games.
We're going to find that out for the years.
Oh, jeez.
Trust me.
Yeah, three games might be 50 passes.
Instead, just boots it down the center of the field. Picked up on the hop and a rugged return across the 37 by Melvin Ingram, the linebacker. But you think, really, that a quarterback might be doing something wrong if he's going that many attempts without an interception. It sounds crazy, but you think that a lot of guys are too afraid of picks.
I've seen guys get into that mode where I don't want to throw any interceptions, and they dump the ball off too early, the ball comes out too early, they don't give it a chance up the field, and they get very conservative. And a lot of coaches will drain that into you.
Woodson doesn't, you know, he's not.
No, he's still going up the field.
This is a guy that he can go down the field, and he'll take it down the field. He's a quarterback that takes what the defense gives him. And so I really believe that he's probably over with Sanders right now, and they're trying to figure out exactly what's taking place up front as much as what they're happening in the secondary.
It's Mike Davis in the ball game for Boyd. They fake it to him. Here's McKinley. And McKinley, yards after the catch. So impressive. This guy is slippery. He's got a first down across the 42 before Lindley forces him out.
He's a lanky receiver, you know, but he's got good hands and excellent vision, and his feet, when he gets the football, he's gone. I mean, watch his feet, the way he goes. He's decisive. You know, I'm here, get me the ball. I know where the defense is.
It's a nice job by Smelly, not forcing the ball down the field. He takes the guy underneath. You still get 10 yards out of it. Freshman doing a good job at QB.
11 yards for the leading receiver. Sidney Rice, of course, left this team for the NFL. Decision that a disappointed Spurrier. McKinley was the second receiver on this team a year ago. Now he's got to be the man. And he keeps his streak alive. 27 straight games with at least one catch. Smelly wants to fire near side. Nobody there looking for McKinley, but he was pretty well bracketed.
But you know what? We watch a lot of tape. We watch a lot of different systems. Watch Kenny McKinley's feet here. Watch how this is called a foot fire. And there are not a lot of programs that teach it. And what he's trying to do there, you saw he wanted to go inside, so the foot fire really takes the defensive back. It pushes him back so that he doesn't get forced and pushed at the line of scrimmage. That foot fire is a great technique to allow the receivers to get open. They teach it. Mike Leach is excellent at teaching it out at Texas Tech. They won't let you play unless you know how to do a foot fire.
I had foot fire one time. Took a week to get rid of it. Second and 10. Smelly fakes the handoff. Now fires to McKinley. McKinley into Kentucky territory at the 45. 13 yards, and this is a pretty sharp start for the redshirt freshman quarterback.
All right, let's see if he's done it, Doug. You know what? Let's see what his feet
exactly
are doing
what
here.
We're talking
about. Boom, boom. And you see the hard plant. He got the DB off of him. That allowed him to get where he wanted to go.
And also in press coverage, he bought himself time for the guy going to the flat to clear out before he makes his break on the slant, gives himself some space.
When you're playing in the slot, you're usually not facing the other team's best defensive back either.
Usually it's about the number three corner over there in that slot.
Well, he'll come in motion, top of the formation there. They flip it off. And Davis powers ahead inside the 40 before Lindley makes the stop. So the Kentucky defense is off balance here.
That was almost like a downfield screen. The receivers were doing the blocking on this little swing screen. And right away, they weren't even running the route. They were going to defenders, saw the ball thrown, and make their blocks. Good job of blocking downfield by receivers.
And this is the question, guys, about this Kentucky team that people have had. When they see the ranking up there at number 8, they respect the wins over Louisville and Arkansas. But it hasn't been done with defense. And is this defense good enough to justify that ranking and stamp them as a legitimate contender? Hit in the backfield, grabs answering that statement.
They heard you.
Davis is dropped for a loss as big Braxton Kelly, the junior out of LaGrange, Georgia there.
Well, in my opinion, Steve Brown has got to keep, he's got to do some stunt work. He's got to bring them up and get them on the box and put pressure on the South Carolina offensive line. You see the movement there? These El Pasos, these crossings.
He describes his guys as a blue-collar group. He doesn't think he has those stud defensive players that are going to do it one-on-one.
Not a lot of draft picks on this defense, he says. Just good, solid guys. See if they can get the Gamecocks off the field on 3rd and 9. Four receivers in the formation. They bring pressure. Gamecocks pick it up, and Smelly fires over the head. Here comes a flag. Jared Cook, the athletic tight end, was covered by Roger Williams. The throw was very high, but no hesitation, two flags on the field.
Not the greatest route in the world, created no separation, DB all over him. And the DB
vanilla. Remember, we used to have practices.
He just kind of rounded that cut and went on out there.
Don't give me vanilla.
Because it was a great blitz pickup by the back in the backfield. The O-line gave him an opportunity to throw the ball. The receiver did not get open one-on-one.
Was it too tall to catch?
Pass interference. Nope. Number 35 on the defense. The penalty will be enforced at the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
And the leader of the secondary, Williams.
Well, you know, Chris, you visited with Jesse Palmer this week. Tell us about what he said Coach Spurrier wants to do with your eyes and not giving it away early.
He said the pet peeve, and Smelly backed it up, do not tip off where you're going to throw. Not only do you want him to look off the DBs, don't ever look at the receiver that you are throwing at. Don't ever.
At some point, no. I think you got to look out there, don't you, Coach? But I understand what he's saying.
It's human nature.
But Palmer,
you want to know where that free safety is. You want to keep your eyes in the middle as long as possible. But
in other words, I need to know where they're over there.
I can't see too much anyway, all right, Coach? I got to see what's going on.
He's not kidding, though. He does not want you to look at the receiver. You just got to trust that the receiver's going to be in that place. They fake the handoff, and Smelly fires for the end zone. Had McKinley open, overthrew him. And a flag at the line of scrimmage. Spurrier frustrated, and we'll check the flag. But again, McKinley was open and a hold. We'll move him back anyway.
Tell you what, on McKinley, you're going to have to change up some coverage back there, because this young man, he can run routes and is good. He'll find the open. You see how he just avoids traffic? The move to get to the post, there's nothing vanilla about that.
Well, the ball, I'm looking at the way the ball should have been thrown. It should have been more of a line drive ball right at him instead of leading him to the opposite side.
Could that be one of those I'm afraid to throw it perfect in case of an interception balls?
He put it in a safe spot.
Yeah.
It didn't matter. The hold would have nullified it anyway.
Yeah, just would have frustrated
Steve Spurrier. He's filed it away.
Steve Spurrier would have been more upset, so the heck with it. I'm going to throw this one away.
And first and 20, it's Corey Boyd back in the ballgame. No real sign of that knee sprain. He's got the ball in the flat. Gets a block, but short gain to the 36. Paul Warford, the corner, was there.
You see the old ball coach, how he just says, all right, boys, let's get back first in a busload here. Let's get down and where we can at least have a field goal opportunity.
Nice safe play, little swing screen. The receiver has to go down and crack. Receivers don't always like to block downfield. They're asking the receivers on these designed little swing plays to go bust somebody.
Hey, you're pretty good blockers this team.
Absolutely. Hey, nowadays, if you want to play wide receiver, big-time college football, you better be an excellent blocker downfield.
Well, I don't want to be, so I'm not going to block.
They certainly expect that, Doug, here. You wouldn't get many reps. Play clock winding down to three as Smelly snaps it on second and 16. Pressure from the backside. Delivers incomplete. Going up for the ball was Freddie Brown. Shamari Moore, the backup corner, was there, but this was all about the blitz. Knocked the quarterback down.
And again, I think this is a game where Smelly's going to have his shoulder pads readjusted several times. You see the crossing stunt in the middle, and there's confusion on the outside.
Yeah, Woodward comes off the edge, and he is the athlete of this defense. He got there in a hurry. The ball was still kind of on the money, though. He stood in there and threw it.
You don't want to put that
yard.
Y in there on his
yard.
Wood, the guy is loving his justice, national TV.
Do you want to say yard?
Wood yard.
Okay. Good yard.
Keep an eye on number 16 in the third and 16 play. This time they pick up the pressure, and Smelly fires to a wide open McKinley inside the 15. They cannot cover number 11, 23 more yards.
The thing about McKinley is once he gets there, Doug, man, you know he's going to find the pocket. He's going to find the soft opening. You're going to see three defensive backs around him. McKinley goes, finds the soft, and sets in there.
Great anticipation. Just throws it into the open window, trusting that receiver that he's going to come around and bend into that open area. Great anticipation. Nice job sitting down, catching the ball, protecting himself.
Your kind of guy, isn't it?
Yeah. I'll take five of those out on the field.
Smelly continues to execute well on third down as they convert that third and 16. Three catches from McKinley on this drive. This time it's Corey Boyd pulling ahead.
That's kind of what I expected to see a little more of right there. A little smash mouth, 3-4 yards.
You know, this just feels like a game that South Carolina's had control of, doesn't it?
I would say.
say so. I mean,
and Woodson, the Heisman candidate, sitting over on the bench, and what I say, he's crystallizing over there.
And I could have panicked being behind. You thought Kentucky had to come from behind against Louisville and on the road at Arkansas. They played very well in the fourth quarter. Three in the play clock and the 10th play of this drive. Smelly fires for the end zone. Incomplete. McKinley couldn't hold on.
He was begging for that ball to hurry up and get to him before they close. I'm sure he thought this ball was going to get tipped.
Well, you know what? He may have had his eyes in the middle of the field on that first look, and then he came to the side. Outstanding effort.
It was deflected just before it got to McKinley. Shamari Moore getting his fingertips on it. Still, McKinley believes that'll be the one he should have had. Third and eight. Can he keep the magic alive on third down? Timeout called. The play clock winding down. So pretty good execution by Spurrier's offense. He likes what he sees from the redshirt freshman quarterback, up by four and looking for more. And 25 losses. That's a mark that was accumulated mostly in his 12 years at Florida when he won six conference titles. Third down. Boyd is the deep back. Fake it to him. Smelly fires for the end zone. Incomplete. Again, he was looking for McKinley. And Warford was on the coverage. So twice close to touchdowns in that quarter to number 11.
Every secondary coach has this drill where his defensive backs trail the receiver and have to strip. Watch the hands, Doug.
Closed on the ball, got the arm in there. Yeah. McKinley, he just wants the ball to get there sooner. Just come on, ball, hurry up and get here.
You putting that on the quarterback?
No. No.
Those are both catchable, especially that one.
Catch. Good strip job by the defensive back.
First one was tipped. That one was stripped.
29-yarder for Ryan.
Come up with one out of two.
0 for 2, buddy.
So the Gamecocks have moved the ball pretty well. The offense has just a field goal to show for it.
And again, you know, the stripping of the ball, there's the tip. It gets up and deflects the ball just enough. But he's going to McKinley, all right? And then he comes back the next time, Doug. And this is just, give credit to the defense.
Get it low and away. Get that throw outside low and away. See how McKinley had to settle his feet? I'm not.
Make a play.
It was a decent throw. Not the perfect throw. Coach will tell him on the film session, yeah, get that ball outside.
Make a play. 139 offensive yards, only a field goal to show for it for the Gamecocks offense. Their touchdown coming on the Norwood fumble return.
Here's the point I'm trying to make. South Carolina has 23 snaps offensively, right? And you've got Kentucky over here with 11. Your Heisman guy can't get going if he's not on the field, can he?
No.
And so, I mean, this is just a game where it's working out nicely for South Carolina at this point.
Yeah, and they thought they threw away 7 points initially after a nice long drive, evened it up, created the turnover, got in the end zone anyway. So they were fortunate to get that touchdown, but they're doing a great job of keeping him on the bench.
And getting a good job pressuring Woodson. Final minute of the first quarter. This boot taken at the 5-yard line by Burton. The All-SEC receiver stopped just short of the 30-yard line. That's where Woodson will go back to work as we check in with Reese Davis for a 30 at 30 update. Reese?
All right, Chris, we'll get started with playoff baseball. And for the first time in his career, Kaz Matsui went yard with the bases loaded. They call it a grand slam. Rocks have won 8 straight on the road, 16-17, and 1 game away from sweeping the Phillies. Jamie Moyer will dig in and try to get it done on Saturday. And Marion Jones acknowledges that she used steroids before the 2000 Olympics. She won 3 gold medals in those Olympics. That story from the Washington Post. SportsCenter after the game, stay current, ESPN News.
Reese, thank you. Woodson changing some things at the line. Snaps it with 2 in the play clock, and good checkoff there as he finds Keene and Burton across the 40.
You know, we're talking about eyes, and Andre Woodson, he's now on the field, but Aaron, I guess he's also trying to help his defense a little bit.
That's what a leader should do. We'll hear from Aaron in a second. They need to get some offense going right here on this possession. Take the handoff, and Woodson fires deep. There's a man wide open and missed him. It was Burton. And they blew a coverage. Woodson, a little too much adrenaline.
Hey, Aaron, I guess you heard Woodson saying something to his defense.
Yeah, he wasn't taking a break over on the sidelines when the defense was out there. When they came back, that being the Kentucky defense, when they came back to the sideline, Andre grabbed a few members of that defense and said, look at Chris Smellie's eyes. He's telling you what he's going to do with his eyes. Chris, that's exactly what Jesse Palmer said Steve Spurrier can't stand when his quarterbacks do.
Aaron, that's the Cardinals' sin. But, hey, it's working out okay, Smellie. Playing pretty well, and Little has the delayed handoff, tries to turn the corner, and slamming into him and making the stop is Stoney Woodson. No fumble. So set up a third and about five for the Cats. This is a Gamecock defense. We talked about the youth. At times you'll see three or four true freshmen on the field. Tyrone Nix not afraid to put the talented young guys in there. There's Jasper Brinkley out with a knee injury. If the NCAA grants him a sixth year, he'll come back. In the meantime, his brother, Casper, holding down the fort. So that's the end so far from the Gamecocks defense, holding Kentucky's high-powered offense to just 51 yards in the first quarter. Cats 0 for 2 on third down, and they face a third and five near midfield right here. This offense is not very effective. And they have to convert third downs from this range. They've been ahead in the count, to use the coach's term, a lot this season. Woodson on a delay. Nice high catch by Dickie Lyons, and he has a first down. Dickie Lyons Jr., his dad was a hero at Kentucky, out of New Orleans, makes a nice catch, 8 yards.
He's a hero on this play here. You get the screen that sniffed out up top, Doug, and he comes back to his number two option.
It looked like a jailbreak type screen. Everybody, it could have been a huge play if he had been able to get upfield right away, but a fantastic one-handed catch. Usually he doesn't catch the ball unless he's going to score a touchdown.
He takes a beating. Norwood got him after the completion. Four receivers set. Woodson flips it out in the flat. This is Burton. Burton has room. Nice job collaring him right there by Emmanuel Cook, the safety. It looked like a bigger gain than that.
I really think college football needs to adopt what the NFL has with that collar rule. Put it in.
Outlaw, you mean?
Outlaw.
No
because
doubt.
It just for safety's sakes.
That just looks dangerous. He can get his legs wrapped up underneath here and fall back just to ask him for trouble.
Yeah, horse collar, not illegal in college football. Second and two. It's Raphael Littles. Little stutter step. Little into the secondary. Inside the 20. We talked about both teams really struggling on run defense. You got one of the esoteric stats for you guys. Ready for this? We got this multi-page printout of stats.
Yeah.
Got a good research department. These teams give up a bunch of runs of 10 yards or longer. They're among the worst in the country in that department coming in. Kentucky giving up 36, South Carolina 38. That's a bunch.
You may have to go back with me on that esoteric stuff.
That's the second run of 10 or more for Kentucky tonight. The Gamecocks have had some as well. That's not good when you're giving up that many.
Is that what
and you're still
means?
Somehow ranked in the top 11. Woodson, pressure. Norwood doesn't chase him down, and the veteran just throws it away.
You know, Coach, when you're watching the game and they hand the ball off, the guy goes that way a little ways, it's not good. They don't have a good run defense. That's what I know. You got these pages. I
no,
don't.
But that's a stat that shows that it's not good.
Hey, Coach Nix, you know, he's getting the job done. Hey, you got to go back for
get her done.
On the esoteric here.
Esoteric stat.
Yeah. Yeah. Is he looking
inside
in their
the
eyes?
Numbers.
There you go. Is he looking in their eyes? Is he going to bench somebody? You say he looks at them, and he doesn't like to look in their eyes. Somebody else is playing.
Well, Norwood breathing hard after unsuccessfully chasing Woodson. Second and 10. He rotates a lot of guys. They do play a lot of people on defense to keep bodies fresh. Little on the delay. Has room. And he's hammered by Cook in the backfield for about a 7-yard gain.
Talk about a form tackle.
Chris Spielman would come out of the booth on that one.
Fundamentals.
Yes, fundamentals. Wrap, bring your feet with you, young man. But there's Tyrone Nix. You know, it's been really fun to watch his development as a coach. Been around him for a long time. He understands football. I'll tell you what he does well. He communicates and gets his players playing football.
They've been stingy. Nix's defense on third down. This is 3rd and 3. Woodson, and it's loud, trying to change the play. 3 on the play clock. And now a flag comes in.
Before the snap, cold start, number 76. Third down.
You know, I know the offense is looking for an advantage. They get to the ball, they dummy cadence, they get a look at the defense, the coaches signal in, they go to a different play, they want to get there. But boy, it's got to drive you nuts up front to hold that position for that long of a time and wait for all these audibles.
Sophomore Jeffries unable to do it, so it's 3rd and 8. He's going right into the Gamecock student section. Woodson flips for the end zone. A leaping catch for a touchdown by Jacob Tammy. Beautiful throw. He beats Darian Stewart on the coverage. That was an All-American throw.
It well, sure was.
And that's what happens when you get a 6'5 receiver going against a defensive back that's 5'11. Throwing the ball up, being smart, let your receiver do the job.
And Woodson had pressure in his face, giving ground. He knew the guy was one-on-one, laid it up to the back, and let his 6'5 receiver go up and make a play.
He had to stand in there as Norbert was again pressuring him. They're going to take a look in the replay booth at this. It would be Tammy's 2nd touchdown reception of the season if it stands. What do you think?
Absolutely.
Well, you didn't even see his foot come down yet.
Doesn't matter. I saw it live. He's got 3 feet
in.
He's got 2 feet in the knee.
2 feet in the knee. He's got 3 down, boss.
They're being very careful here in the replay booth.
Of course, the left hand on the back helps a little bit to keep the DB away from him.
That's just good receiver play.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm all for it, of course.
Not pushing. He was just feeling him.
Tammy, the senior from Danville, former wide receiver. He runs a 4.5 40 wow. At 240 pounds. Good athlete.
And you know what I like about this offensive line and this unit at Kentucky is they've taken a lot of former tight ends and turned them into linemen, a lot of defensive linemen and brought them to the offensive line. They're mm-hmm. athletic. They move around.
Absolutely. And LSU did the same thing. They were getting defensive linemen over there. They're offensive linemen with better feet, movement. You can do a lot more.
And if you're going to play in the SEC, you better be nasty and mobile up front because you know the defensive lineman.
After review, video confirms the call on the field. Touchdown.
Wasn't much doubt about that. So, Kant's a Sieber conversion away from tying it. And you see Andre Woodson's mom, Robin. Interesting life. She's been in the armed forces. Andre is actually born in Berlin behind the wall when it was still standing. Robin serving there. Spent some time in Hawaii before settling in Kentucky.
She was actually born right behind the wall.
He grew up.
Tied up at 10 here in Columbia, South Carolina. Andre Woodson, many say he's right there for the Heisman, and his mother in attendance tonight, Robin Woodson, a fantastic story. His mother in the Army. Now, his parents divorced when he was the age of 2, so he says, it was my mom who would throw the football to me in the backyard. She attended all my youth camps, all my games, did all my constructive criticism. Chris, so much when Woodson was pulled for Curtis Pulley back a couple years ago, he said his mom pulled him aside and said, look, this is it. How are you going to feel when your teammates are running past you and you've got the clipboard in your hand? This is your time. Do something with it.
Hello, Mom.
Yes.
Good advice, though, and he certainly took it and did not waste all the promise that he brought to Lexington when he came in as a titled recruit. He's been in the shadow of Brian Brown in that state throughout most of his career. Finally had the breakthrough, the first head-to-head win against the more heralded quarterback growing up in his career when they beat the Cardinals earlier this season.
Well, how often do you hear of a school beginning to recruit a kid when he's in the 9th grade? Which is what Kentucky did with Woodson.
Right.
You know, it paid off for them.
This is the first year he had the talent surrounding him to have a legitimate shot of beating Brom. And he pulled that out in the last seconds.
So Mike Davis back in the ballgame. And Spelly gets a first down throw. Gets pressure. Now dumps it off. Very short throw to Davis, and he'll lose 10. Sniffing out the play was Micah Johnson, the backup Mike Backer, and Jeremy Jarman, the defensive end.
Did Spurrier have a throw-in incident there? You know, because we said it. We asked
him. Oh, we lost the headset.
Yellow, lost a headset and game plan on the ball plays down there.
I don't think that qualifies as throwing on time.
That's not a throw. That wasn't a throw.
That wasn't
he just more of a shovel pass of the headset.
The chart?
Oh, wait a minute. It was a throw.
I don't know.
It'll check him out. That might have been a throw. You got to get a replay on that.
He's still complaining about a face mask that wasn't called. But it's second and 20. Smelly pump fakes, fires downfield. McKinley is there, but this one is off the target. Marcus McClinton, the safety, got a fingertip on it. But McKinley not open that time.
Does it look like to you that he's maybe throwing to an area as opposed to a specific route?
Yeah, he put that ball up real early, did the pump fake, let it fly in a situation where the guy was covered. Here's the other play. Let's take a look.
That was a throwdown. You
that's
saw
a
the
definite throw. All right, we're back.
And we just asked him yesterday.
How long's it been?
It's been a while.
He didn't know the last visor.
Woodson's streak ended last week. Now his streak ends this week.
First toss of the season. They're 3 of 5 on third down, but this is third and 20. Gantz, bring light pressure. Smelly just tries to get rid of the ball. Here comes a flag. Is it going to be ruled grounding in the end zone? That would be a safety. Ventrell Jenkins and Jeremy Jarman were pressuring Smelly. Now, where was he when he threw the ball away?
Intentional grounding, number 7 on the offense. The penalty will be enforced at the spot of the foul. Loss of down, fourth down.
He was hit outside the end zone. He was not going to be a safety, but I think in his mind he was thinking this is going to be a safety. I got to get rid of it. And now, by the time the ball leaves his hand, the ball, I think, is in the end zone.
Well, yeah, okay, agreed.
He's down.
Yes, agreed. He was outside the goal line. Better shot of it right here.
His knees were actually on the ground, and he was down before he even threw the ball. So if that were to be reviewed, it would have been marked at the 1 yard line anyway.
Ryan Suckup, who does the place kicking and the punting. It's a shallow formation. A dangerous Raphael Little standing at the Gamecocks 40. Takes a step to his right and boots it rugby style. Very effective punt. And he'll roll dead on the Wildcats side of the field. So that was effective 52 yards. But Woodson, after a tying touchdown drive, gets the football back in great position. Somebody runs in this
food
metal canister. My two partners here attack it.
Well, you know, Todd Blackledge on Saturday nights, he does his delicatessen tour around, you know, restaurants.
Yeah.
We got peanuts goobers that come to our box. You got
popcorn lard.
How can you eat that?
Guaranteed worst in town. Worst in town. How's that for a slogan?
Guaranteed the worst thing to eat when you're trying to do a game. Because that's
absolutely.
You get that,
we open up one of these.
Stuck
they're
in
wet.
The throat.
They're moist.
They're moist. I don't know. I won't go near those.
That's a rookie mistake to start chewing on popcorn in the middle of a telecast, unless you want to hit the mute button. This is Tony Dixon, and the junior in the ballgame for the first time, to the right of Woodson. They fake it to him, and Woodson, as a flag flies in the holding area, flips it out and had Burton open. He broke open late, but this is going to be a hold against that Cats offensive line as Norwood is providing pressure again.
Boy, Norwood's got a motor. He's got the SEC motor to be successful. And he leads. This guy's only a sophomore.
He played as a true freshman in the SEC on the defensive line. You got to be pretty good to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't out of necessity. He was just better than the guys in front of him. Gary Williams, the tackle, is guilty of the hold.
How about our meeting yesterday with Chris Smelly, and right after him was Norwood, and Smelly's headed off to take an economics test.
Yeah.
Norwood was ready to, I don't think he was going to economics.
He was focused. Game face on right away, didn't he?
He said he always has that game face on. Handed off inside. Dixon shows the quicks and gets some of the penalty yardage back, seven of it.
You said it earlier. Last week, there were four freshmen on the field at the same time on this defense. I mean, this is a young talent. People ask me about Spurrier's team. I say, hey, here's my opinion. He's recruiting really well right now because there are a lot of good young players starting to come playing for him.
Well, when you get freshmen on the field, they're going at full speed no matter what. They may be in the wrong spot, but if they're going to make a mistake, they're going to make it at full speed.
Now, those freshmen who are playing, too, are four- and five-star recruits. Spurrier had one of the better recruiting classes in the country. Woodson fires, and it's caught, forced out at the 41-yard line for a first down is Steve Johnson, his first catch of the night. They continue to spread the ball around nicely, 14 yards. Tough to just focus in on Keenan Burton.
You know, Woodson in the pocket looks so relaxed. It's almost like he looks lazy. He's just standing there under control, delivering the ball right out of the break.
See the youth on this team? He'll be very good in the years to come. Woodson fires down the middle. Into traffic, looking again for Tammy. Three Gamecocks in the area, broken up. Not afraid to look for the tight end, the big 6'5 guy against three DBs.
Free safety. I thought Isaac should have come over and got an interception.
He was waiting there the whole time, and Woodson never saw the free safety coming from the backside of the field, coming
left
across
to right.
Left to right there. And this should have been a pick. Receiver goes up, makes a play for him, though, allowing it to go in. Sometimes you got to get lucky.
But again, you got a 6'5 tight end running down the middle of the field from the wide receiver. It helps you, a quarterback.
Brandon Isaac, part of the depth of this defense on second down. Little moving well behind some of those big offensive linemen. Motors down near the 20. Another of those runs of longer than 10 yards against this Gamecock defense. 19.
I'm convinced it's the running game that makes this offense go.
That was Dixon, not Little.
They'll use three running backs, and they also have a freshman, Derek Locke, that'll come in, who's a track star. So there are a lot of different players that they can rush in and out of that backfield, and sometimes they've had to out of the necessity because of injury.
Now, Alfonso Smith is injured, and he's the third stringer. Has a high ankle, not playing tonight. Dixon, a very quick little changeup back, and he's got it again. Fumbles the football, fallen on by Kentucky. Little hammered as he went in there. Gary Williams falling on the fumble, avoiding the turnover. For the week that shuffled up the standings in Nextel Cup, the chase continues, moving to Talladega, one of the great tracks, the high banks there in the Tri-Oval. Who can avoid the big one? Main in position to make a run at the title. One Eastern NASCAR countdown on ABC Sunday. Second and seven, Little back in the ballgame. Slips out into the flat and catches it. Here's Raphael Little. Darting down near the 12-yard line. Should have a first down. That's tough to stop, huh?
You know, Andre's throwing a lot of these little hit screens, little flare screen there to the tailback, the middle screens, the bubbles. He's throwing the ball, what, downfield two or three times and put it up to the big guy. But the offense is more run, and efficient passing game.
And, you know, the thing that he's doing is luring that defense to come up and play that little dump game, and he's going to have a deep ball.
There you go.
Well, you got first down at the 12. Little behind the fullback, John Connor. And they run the stretch. Little cuts it back, dances down to the 9-yard line. Marvin Sapp on the stop. And Kentucky so efficient, effective this season in these situations.
You know, Joker Phillips, the offensive coordinator of Kentucky, is a part of a staff under Rich Brooks that's experienced as a player, been there in big games. And I think that preparation that Brooks has brought for his team this year, and in particular tonight, Doug, really is paying off.
Phillips has done a good job, been a big part of the improvement of this offense, replacing Ron Hudson. Brooks has been very loyal to him. Woodson has the football, flips into the end zone, intercepted. A bad decision by the All-American, and here comes Captain Munnerlin. And he motors out near the 40. Anderson is on the field. He tried to make a tackle, slow to be helped up on his offensive line. Second turnover for Woodson. 38 yards on the return from Munderland, his second pick of the season.
They kind of lured him into this throw, didn't they, Doug?
Captain's just sitting back there laying in the weeds. There's not enough depth to the end zone here. They were too close that the corner could just let his receiver go, react to the ball in the air, and break on the tight end coming across.
You can see Woodson didn't have an interception in 325 attempts until that pick last week. He blamed that one with a little bit of a smile on his fullback. That one was all his fault. And this is Mike Davis plowing out near the 45. We'll see if, once again, the turnover can change momentum in this game. This guy's a big-time cover corner with a next-level future, Munderland.
Great job of using your eyes and almost cheating, I call it, by a corner, of seeing the ball thrown, reacting to it in the air, coming off your man, making a play.
Obviously expected Burton to do something different in that route. Smelly still has it, rolls out, takes his shot, almost intercepted. He threw that one right at Roger Williams, who couldn't hold on.
He threw it late, is what he did. Because he was open early on, he had it both dump routes, throw the ball.
Coach, I'm trying to give it back to him, but they didn't want it. Williams is like, you know what, I don't want it just yet. Smelly got away with a bad throw, and to live another down. When that ball hits the ground on those kind of passes, he was very thankful, go back to the huddle, and let's convert third down.
And they've been converting long third downs. This one, the first third and short of the night. Davis is the tailback. Three on the play clock. Snapped it just in time. Smelly pressured and sacked. So on third and short, drop for a loss. Aaron?
Chris, I'm standing behind UK's sideline here watching the trainers look at Andre Woodson. He has said to them a few times, I'm fine, but it looks like they're doing a little couple of tests on him, series of, you know, say a couple numbers, say a few sentences. He's walking away now. I'm trying to see where he's going. But he's been telling them he's fine. It looks like they're trying to see how bad his head was rattled.
He's being cautious down there.
The knee, the leg hit him in the face mask from the runner, and it made him woozy a little bit there.
He tried to dive to make the tackle, and as the runner went by, I thought his leg might have caught him in the head, too.
His mother, Robin, here too concerned. That's always her wish, though. She'd like him to win, but she wants him to come out of the game healthy, like most parents.
You know, the last play, they're doing all that audibleizing, and they snapped the ball anyway. The tight end didn't have the call. A couple of linemen weren't sure of the call. Sometimes it just pays off to go up there and run a play.
Delay of game on the offense, number 14, 5-yard penalty. It remains fourth down.
Spurrier was joking about that, Doug, but when they went into LSU, he said it was so noisy there. The good news for us is our quarterback, maybe he won't audible. And that was Blake Mitchell at the start of that game.
I love that theory. As an old school guy behind the center, just call the play and let me run it.
Suck up, boots it. Pretty good boot. Taking it at the 27-yard line is Little. He turns the corner and dances out of bounds. So, Kentucky, which rarely, and I mean rarely, forces a three and out, which is another one of those esoteric stats that Craig likes so much. They do force a three and out there, and Woodson's interception doesn't cost the Cats. 10-10 in the second quarter. The 25 greatest players will be counted down all the way until New Year's Day. So the Cats take over. Raphael Little is the setback behind Woodson. He gets the call. We'll see if Woodson can shake off just his second interception of the season and shake off the cobwebs from that hit to try to make the tackle on the return.
Come out and run the football. Make sure that he does have his senses about him out here.
Well, sometimes when you get dinged like that, though, it takes a little while for that to set in, and you can, the concussion can come on after a little while.
The backup is a freshman, Mike Hartline from Canton, Ohio. Woodson fires into traffic, and a nice catch by Keenan Burton in Gamecock territory. Went up over Darian Stewart for 22 yards. A flag is down near where the pass was thrown. And it will come back.
Honestly, I thought Woodson got away with another throw there. He thought it was one-on-one coverage, and when the receiver went by the DB, he drove it into the window.
Number 66 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat second down.
The safety was coming over the top and almost got there.
But he threw it with some velocity.
So I think he saw him at the last instant. He saw the safety breaking and put a little extra juice on it.
I can hear you, Doug. You're not real impressed so far with Woodson, are you?
Here's
don't
an impressive
call me out like that. But
impressive
right now,
list of guys here. Keenan Burton's favorite wide receivers of all time. Glenn Holt, by the way, if you're wondering what that's all about, he plays for the Bengals Cincinnati. He's a Kentucky guy, so he makes the list with Lynn Swann and Jerry Rice. On second and 18. Misfire again looking for Burton.
I think South Carolina and Tyrone Nix have done an outstanding job of mixing it up, which is what their goal was. Up front, last year they confused them with three men down and a couple of linebackers stacked. Coach Nix has been around before. He knows how to get a team ready strategically to confuse a quarterback.
And he said outside they want to do a little press coverage and bail, make it look like press to discourage the quick rhythm passing.
Third and 18, and a safe call. And a short gain for Little, and they'll punt it. Emmanuel Cook on the stop.
And here's why it's a safe call. This team, as you said earlier, Chris, they're used to not being ahead early. Only twice at halftime have they led this season. So don't push the panic button. You're on the road, hostile environment, playing pretty good. Let your quarterback get his nugget back together upstairs.
His nugget, huh?
Yeah, you got one nugget if you're a ball player. You got two.
I had a coach who told me it's all right to kick the ball. Let's just kick the ball once in a while.
And so after the three and out, turn Maste on to punt.
Of course, I never agreed with it.
Munnerlyn over his head. And he'll just let that go. What a boot. Rolls dead at the 11-yard line. 63 yards on the punt. This is Corey Boyd pulling up the middle for a short game. Joined on the phone by our colleague Bill Curry, among his many stops coaching, was the Wildcats coach in Lexington. I know, Bill, you can fully appreciate the challenge that Rich Brooks took on when he came there facing probation and a real lack of tradition. What do you think of the job he's done?
Well, he's done a marvelous job along with the staff and the support group. Kentucky has always had potential, and I think what they've done that we had not seen done before, was not accomplished in the past, is the collection of talent, the sheer offensive weapons and the defensive speed, just different than it's been before. They've done a great job.
See Jared Cook, the tight end for the Gamecocks, making the catch from Smelly. Can it be done at Kentucky? They're wondering the same thing here in South Carolina. The faithful believe it, but can it be done? Can they win the SEC East at one of the, quote, traditional second-tier programs?
Oh, absolutely. The traditional second-tier programs require a change in the culture. I used to talk to Lou Holtz about it when Lou was at South Carolina. It's one of the most difficult things in the world, but you have to change not just, you don't have to just change the talent and get good with a good quarterback and a good defense, but you got to get people thinking differently all over the state. And I think that's happening in both places.
Boyd breaking loose. Now, they're certainly enthusiastic in Kentucky as Boyd bowls into Kentucky territory. They get the big home games with LSU and Florida coming up. Is this defense, though, Bill, you mentioned defense, always an important part of the SEC. Is this defense good enough for Kentucky this year?
Well, this defense, it's been opportunistic. It has not been a steady defense that stones people. It has a great third down ratio and all those kinds of things that you'd like to see, but they've been able to make big plays at key times. That's how they managed to win the Louisville game and the Arkansas game.
First down now at the 47, and they'll give it back to Davis, who slams ahead for a short gain. You obviously faced Steve Spurrier quite a lot in your career. This is a very different-looking Spurrier offense, and working with a young quarterback, you can see the frustration.
Well, I have tried to forget the times that we faced Steve Spurrier.
I wasn't going to mention that.
Well, not only did he have great talent, but he's a great football coach. What he did at Duke University, when he won the ACC at Duke, that is, I think, harder than anything he did at Florida. But he is the toughest game day coach that I ever went up against. He can beat you with his brain.
See if his brain can translate into a play from Smelly here on second and seven. Smelly feels some pressure up the middle, fires, and McKinley, did he hold on? Juggling, they say, no catch. McKinley made some catches tonight, but he's had a tough time holding on to some other throws. Well, it has to be brought up as we check the replay. Bill, when you got to Georgia Tech, there was a young assistant named Spurrier, did not retain him on the staff. Were you guys, did you speak a lot after that?
Well, the illusion has been put out that I fired him. That staff was fired, and I was told I could keep who I wanted, and I spoke with Steve, and then he took the coordinator's job at Duke before I made up my mind. So, you know, we've been friends all through it. I don't know how that illusion got started. Obviously, if I had known he was a genius, I would have been on my knees begging him to stay.
Yeah, that is one of those misconceptions, and this is a completion. Freddie Brown has a first down inside the 35-yard line. Bill, thanks for your time. We appreciate it.
Yeah, be sure that Craig James gets enough to eat. That's the big thing you have to do, Craig.
You got it right, Coach. Absolutely. That's priority number one.
Where do you get enough food?
He eats more than Golic. It's unbelievable.
High metabolism, right?
Well, it looks that way so far. Great talking to you guys.
Good looking drive so far here. All right, Bill, we appreciate it. Davis in the I formation at the 28. Play action. Smelly fires on time. McKinley holds on to this one and gets run out at the 17.
Now, McKinley obviously is the favorite target here. 15 yards down the field. This is an impressive drive, mixing it up. Smelly in the pocket, on rhythm, throwing the ball.
Nice little play action. They've been running the ball well. The play action buys you a little extra time. Nice and relaxed in the pocket. When it's man coverage, he's looking for McKinley.
This drive began way back to the 11-yard line of the Gamecocks. They've moved into the red zone where they've been so effective this season. Davis in the flat has a running start. Gets a block in the corner from McKinley, cuts it back down near the 10. Braxton Kelly there to cover him up.
Here's that ball, Coach, working at you. You know, the Bill Curry was just talking about. McKinley on the left side, number 11. He goes over, and there's so much interest in him that it opens up the back out of the backfield.
And I love the fact that he catches a pass, turns around, and is throwing a block for his tailback.
Davis bams down inside the 5. And we're seeing the physical running game. LSU stuffed it cold, but most other opponents haven't been able to.
There is a great rhythm to this drive, whether it's the run, the short pass, the play action, the run again. South Carolina doing a great job.
First and goal. Davis in the backfield. Davis has it, cuts it back, falls into the end zone. Is a touchdown drive. 10 plays, 89 yards, used 326. And Woodson and company in a hole again. Suckup tries to make it a 7-point lead in the final minute of this first half. Smelly 4 of 5 to 4 different receivers on the drive.
You know, there's a bruised leg that Davis has, but inside the red zone, his eyes are looking for Pater. He finds the end zone as well as any back in the SEC.
Great vision for the cutback there. Wasn't there at the point of attack, cut it backside.
And he kind of hops.
He's got that little lateral hop.
He's got that little hop, and then he comes down again, and then he bounds in. I got to tell you, the offensive line has done a heck of a job tonight, much better than I thought they would.
You're a little tired there, Chris.
Worked hard of the draft.
You know what? If I take a nap now, I got 20 minutes because of halftime. I could just get a little quick little nap in here. What do you think?
I think the Wildcat defense is pretty worn out. Let's check in with Reese Davis.
All right, Chris, coming up on the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report, Mark will tell you which matchup will be the key in the Bayou battle between Florida and LSU this weekend. And Holtz the Magnificent will amaze you with his wizardry with the pep talk, and we'll also get you up to date on all of the baseball playoff action. The Rockies on quite a roll trying to sweep the Phils right out, but grabbing a quick lead. We'll see you at halftime, Chris.
The wizardry of the halftime speech. I can't wait to hear that.
Yeah, nice. He's definitely given a few speeches of wizardry.
Gave a few down here.
Yeah, I love
Cox during this program around.
Coach gets me fired up to go play.
Reese came into New York with us, Doug and me last week.
Doug and me.
Did a good job.
Did he teach you grammar?
Well, we worked on that. He stole it from me.
He's from Texas.
It's a whole different grammar.
It's a whole different language. I'm still learning.
Burton's going to run it out from the end zone. As a blocker, cuts, and Keenan Burton still dancing up near the 30-yard line. 44 seconds for Woodson to work with, but the 89-yard touchdown drive for the Gamecocks gives them the lead.
And it was balanced. They were throwing the ball, they were running the ball, they converted third downs, and it was really an excellent job of the offensive line allowing Smelly to run the game plan. Smelly on time, delivering the ball to receivers, to backs out of the backfield, and then the red zone, Doug, give it to Davis, let him run the ball.
Like I said, with those great eyes going backside there and cutting and finding the whole drive, Smelly stood there with his feet under him, did not get touched. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that they ran the ball well, so they go play action and buys them that extra time. Great job up front.
There's a Gamecock down on the field. I believe it's Yvonne Manag, the linebacker, number 30. It is. Boy, this, all the violence of a kickoff return. He takes a big blow, a block right there, just after he maybe relaxed a bit.
You know, the violence that you have on kick coverage is unbelievable. And you can't really practice it because you can't afford that your guys get hurt and you get in the game and all of a sudden it's just, bam, it's on you.
Cats have three timeouts. They'll not take a chance here. Apparently just content to go in down seven. And obviously very comfortable trailing at halftime. Craig, you said they've been in that position in three ball games this year.
Yep, only twice have they ever been ahead at halftime. And I would say here at this point, don't make a mistake, Doug.
Oh, I say you got three timeouts, 44 seconds. In college football, it's an eternity.
That's not a good-looking bird, is it? They're going to throw, though, Burton. See if he can break a big play. Nope. Marion Stewart there in the stop.
You call that a bird?
It's a Gamecock.
Yeah, that's a Gamecock.
Yeah.
It's a rooster.
It's not.
Do they have practice ones if they have game ones?
He'll wake you up in the morning.
He's fired up.
Oh, Floyd.
I'm just wondering. He's for the game, right?
That's the Gamecock. I don't know. No. He's ready every day.
Every day?
Yeah.
He's like Norwood.
17-10. South Carolina has a lead. And Erin Andrews moving into position to visit with Steve Spurrier. Let's go to her.
Coach, what was the difference for your offense in that last drive?
Well, I don't know. We got fortunate. We hit a few passes. We got to run the ball. I've probably been caught too many passes, so we need to try to mix it up better.
How is your defense limited Andre Woodson to just 94 yards?
Our defensive guys can play and they can cover, so we're doing a pretty good job, yeah.
All right, Coach. Thanks. Chris.
That was a great drive. I thought he did a great job of mixing run and pass, and he comes off that drive saying we got to run the ball even more. I think they've done a great job with the mix.
Well, the run defense for Kentucky coming into this game, not good at all. And Spurrier going to a pass-heavy play-calling mix in this first half. This is Dixon at the five. Tony Dixon. Stutter steps, turns the corner. Dixon out near the 30, good return. Let's go to Erin Andrews.
Chris, I spoke with Kentucky head coach Rich Brooks on the way out from the locker room. Two things he wants to see change here in the second half. First of all, turnovers. He said, hold on to the ball. He said, two of those turnovers in the first half really killed us. Second of all, the protection of his quarterback. He felt it was very weak in the first half, and because of that, he felt Andre missed some deep passes. He told me, by the way, Andre is feeling fine. He feels confident with his quarterback out there. He's ready to go.
Aaron, thank you. Just one sack of Woodson in that first half, but they were in his face a lot.
Absolutely, a lot of pressure. They do have to show up that offensive line and pass protection.
First down throw, complete in the flat. Nice little route, slammed to the ground, out of bounds is Dickie Lyons. short completions from Woodson. No real downfield plays, and they do total just 96 passing yards.
Yeah, and you know, I'll tell you something else that when you look at the numbers, the average starting position for South Carolina was their own 21. Kentucky won that battle. They started at their own 34. I mean, the points off turnovers and all that, the starting field position was really tough on South Carolina.
And packs up a defensive touchdown for their first score. This is Little on first down, no gain.
The one downfield ball that Andre Woodson did hit was a nice touch with a rush in his face, falling away, put it up for the touchdown over the top. But other than that, they haven't really been able to go up the field with the ball.
But you talked about a second ago, Craig. That's why Woodson is filled with confidence. This has been a good second half team, specifically a fourth quarter team. This is when this Kentucky team has to step up and prove to this conference and this country they're deserving of this ranking. Woodson fires downfield in traffic. Catch made inside the 40-yard line by Burton. So the go-to receiver goes up and gets it.
And, you know, we were kind of talking through halftime and the adjustments and what you make. The receivers on these ball clubs have to go get the football. Look at the time. Only four rushing. Woodson steps up. Boom. Big arm.
All day, got the weight. The receiver had to work to get into actually the second window. Delivered a strike.
Fourth catch for Burton. Hand it up to Little, who barges forward for about four.
A lot of times at halftime, Rich Brooks and his staff gets together and they start making adjustments up front, looking all the way left, middle, and right, and four. Was that four?
He went from left to right to the swing route, back to the in route. That's why I say he got to the second window. That's too much time in the pocket. The rush got to get there.
Only four rushing.
Depends on who you're talking to, whether it was enough time or not.
Pressure up the middle. The ball thrown away. Was it a lateral? It's scooped up. And heading for the end zone is Eric Norwood. Two touchdowns for number 40. A big mistake. Pressure came up the middle and a bad choice.
But it was only four. Again, South Carolina's defense beating man-to-man up front and a poor decision by Woodson to throw the ball back.
Casper Brinkley had his arms around him and once again Norwood, the great athlete with a nose for the football. Not one but two fumble returns for touchdown.
How's that for a defensive end?
It was 54 yards. Suck up. Puts Kentucky in a 14-point hole.
See if he's still got his game face or breaks a smile after this one.
Casper Brinkley forces it. Norwood scoops and shows the wheels. Woodson and company in a big hole. Second half, Eric Norwood's second defensive touchdown, the 53-yard officially return of the lateral by Woodson. And the three Kentucky turnovers led to those two Norwood touchdowns, and the third ended a drive in the red zone. The interception by Woodson. Suck up to kick it off.
He still didn't bust out a true smile.
Tony Dixon up the middle, and now they'll go right back to work, but this time not down seven, but 14. And we talked about, you know, Kentucky coming in here, ranked number eight, wanting to silence the skeptics, prove they belong. This is one of those precious situations. They have not responded all that well as an offense, and neither has Woodson.
And the man who wanted to show the country that they're not the doormat in the SEC is Andre Woodson. And, you know, the rough start that he has had is not all on his shoulders, but, I mean, this team on the road, I think they expect to be a lot better off right now than they are.
They're only down by two scores now. This isn't over, and they're not necessarily the doormat. They just got to come alive.
No, there's certainly no doormat, but they won't stay in the top 10 for long unless they can rally in the hostile house. And Little carries for a nice gain on first down, forced out by Stewart.
And they have in the past. They've had success in these situations coming from behind. They know what it's like to score the game-winning touchdown in the last minutes. So they should have confidence and should not be rattled.
And they're having success in these opening two drives here in the second half on first down. And with Woodson throwing the football, definitely they're in the game.
Little. First down across the 40. Marvin Sapp on the stop. And this is a gut check for Kentucky, down 14 on the road. You can call it gut check Thursday night, the setup gut check Saturday. Teams that are nicked up, teams like Florida, Oklahoma, Texas, Clemson, Rutgers have to respond.
Well, we get to find out about Cincinnati, Missouri. There's some ball clubs are going to find out about their guts.
First down throw, Woodson looking deep. Keenan Burton overthrown. Carlos Thomas was in the neighborhood. Burton not open.
Well, there are some surprise undefeated teams so far in the country. Arizona State ranked today. You know, of course, I mean, Doug, you totally expected this one to be there.
I don't know.
But hey, I mean,
I don't know that I expected them to be
here,
at number seven.
Purdue, Missouri, you got some ball clubs in there. Kansas.
I just love the mix and the way things have been topsy-turvy this year in college football.
Little into the secondary and into Gamecock territory at the 45. 14 yards. Wildcats, the quarterback struggling a bit, want to go back to the ground game. And this is, again, not a very good run defense for South Carolina.
Well, what you're finding here right now is an offense, when they're throwing the ball, they're keeping extra guys in to block. So Kentucky's only got 2 and 3 men in route, so not a lot of options down the field.
Well, then all of a sudden you get a zone coverage and you have nobody open.
Kentucky approaching 100 yards on the night on the ground. It's the 100th ranked rush defense coming in. Off a new back is Derek Locke, and a freshman breaking loose down inside the 30, keeping fresh legs in the ball game and moving people off the ball 18 more yards.
Tell you about this guy here, Locke. I couldn't wait to see him run in this football game. In high school, he averaged 252 yards a game. He's the Oklahoma State 100 meter champion. Look at the speed.
He was a big factor, Craig, in that fourth quarter rally at Arkansas. He was in the game playing meaningful possessions on the road in the SEC. It's not new to him. Locke again. Cuts it back. Positive game.
This is what I expected to see coming out in the beginning of the game. Kentucky trying to control the ball on the ground because, as we said, they run the ball for over 200 yards a game. South Carolina is not a great run defense. And then allow Andre Woodson to do the play action, hit some big plays in the passing game.
Which also allows your Kentucky offensive line, they're all that nasty attitude, used to be defensive linemen, to get their pads set because so far they haven't gotten their pads set.
Second and six. It's still the true freshman from Oklahoma, a lock in the game. Four, and Woodson wants to fire in the slot, batted down again. What a game Norwood's having. He's making a strong All-American case tonight, the sophomore. Now Saturday, two teams that started off 2-0 in Big Ten play meet on ESPN. DJ Hill and the Badgers travel to Champaign, the fifth-ranked team in the country, underdogs to the unranked Fighting Illini Saturday at noon following College Game Day.
We'll figure that out.
Yeah,
unranked
that.
Illini at home, and they're favored over Wisconsin.
Vegas doesn't care about the rankings, and Wisconsin might be a touch overranked at 5, gentlemen. Third and six. It's still Derek Locke. Woodson flushed and now fires into the end zone, badly overthrowing Burton, who was behind a couple of defenders. Think he meant to throw that away?
Yeah, it would have taken a heck of a throw on the move to his left to try to touch that over the defensive backs. I think he kind of just wanted that out of the end zone. Let's line up and kick a field goal.
Chris, in our study for this game, did you think you would say Woodson's pass batted at the line of scrimmage? 6'5 quarterback, doesn't have many balls.
He's too short.
Because I guarantee you, South Carolina wasn't thinking they were going to bat
these
balls.
He's too short. He's 6'5. He's too short.
Sieber, Mabon from 27. This is from 41. And in his career, he's only 4 of 9 beyond 40. And they get 5 of 10. So Kentucky, a once promising drive, looking for seven, and gets only three and cuts into the lead. Gamecocks by 11. South Carolina's offense will go back on the field. I think they're in hostile territory surrounded by the Gamecock fans there. It's risky to bring an infant to an SEC game right on the road. Now State drives it into the end zone and deciding to come out with it. Stopped short of the 20. Well, the return is Chris Culliver, the freshman, as we check back with Reese Davis.
Chris, as you well know, each week we honor the AT&T ESPN All-America Player of the Week, and this week it was Andre Woodson. Woodson going for over 300 yards passing, five touchdowns. You can vote every week. Text VOTE to 87654 on your AT&T wireless phone. You can win a trip to the national championship game, but Andre's going to have to pick it up if he's going to do it back-to-back weeks, guys.
No doubt, Reese. Three turnovers. The senior quarterback for the Wildcats responsible for needs his defense to get South Carolina off the field here. Good job flying in to trip up the runner was Sam Maxwell, the backup strong side linebacker, the sophomore. Talked about the strength of this team rallying in the second half. Another challenge. They don't believe there's any kind of destiny involved. They're not considering themselves a Cinderella team. They just believe they can do it in these situations.
You can always tell a focused game. Neither bench has players sitting on the bench unless they're being coached. I mean, they're into it.
Haven't been able to beat the Gamecocks since 99. Two on the play clock for Smelly. Under center. Does he get it away? Just barely, and Boyd dropped for a loss. Wesley Woodyard, the senior leader of that defense, top tackler in the backfield. It'll be third and long for Spurrier.
Coach is yelling out the play here to the quarterback on the side, looking for an audible.
31, Tiger 31.
Old Tiger 31, Craig, come on.
Well, I bet we don't hear Tiger 31 here in the next couple plays. They ain't working, Coach.
They had to hurry up, barely got the snap off, and it was a loss. Third and 13. Smelly gets pressure up the middle and misfires. He got hammered after the throw, looking for Cook, the tight end. Dominic Lewis was in his face.
You made a great point, Chris, when you said that real time, 45 minutes that this offense had sat around. And you lose rhythm, you've got to go back out. The worst thing you can do is have a three and out.
Yeah, they very rarely force a three and out at Kentucky. I mean, opponents have a three and out about 13% of the time. That's low.
13%. He's got his sheet out with those stats.
He's playing football.
And Little juggling it. Wow, another disastrous turnover. Captain Munnerlin on the recovery.
Is that about 1% of the time that happens, Chris?
Wow, you see the instructions from Coach Brooks. Just look it into the hands. That was a terrible mistake trying to cut into this lead.
And from a dependable player, a guy that's not been, you know, this is not his first rodeo. And it's just one of those lack of focus, finish the play off.
What a big night for Munnerlin. Had the interception down in the red zone and now the fumble recovery. One of the starters and the most talented players is on all the special teams. And now Mike Davis back in the ballgame. Kentucky defense has to go right back to work. Gamecocks at midfield. Play action fake to Davis. Smelly flips it off, broken up. They're trying to flip it off to Stafford, the little-used fullback, little-used as a receiver, and Woodyard was right there.
You know what? I was going to say, if Spurrier ran the football, he had really changed. Big turnover midfield.
He was going for it.
He
had one-on-one on the post. It was pretty well covered, but it was one-on-one, an opportunity to lay it up.
How about Shane Beamer?
Special teams coach. I don't know if he get
Does
a lot of coaching
count?
Credit for falling on a fumble. But
kind of broke down around the football.
He was there.
And Steve Ortmeyer is the special teams coordinator for Kentucky, the longtime NFL veteran. Got normally reliable special teams for the Cats. Pressure, Smelly sacks. Woodyard again in the backfield. And he's stepping up when Wildcats need defenders to make plays. The leader's doing it.
Steve Brown, the defensive coordinator, he's using his linebackers right now in a delayed blitz method. Watch these two guys back here. Watch how once they read back, come in and stay in the block. Watch them come. Boom, here we go. See it?
See, they both have the back. If the back were released, they both have him in pass coverage, depending on which way he goes. When the back steps up to block, then it frees up the other guy to blitz.
Yep.
Fourth sack of Smelly. Sets up a third and 15. Gotta hurry. Spend a timeout here. There was some confusion and only a couple of seconds on the play clock. Our ESPNU All-State standings. Talked about how shuffled the top 10 has been. Preseason rankings, other than LSU and USC, very, very topsy-turvy top 10. South Florida, Boston College, and Kentucky not ranked. Now they're in the top 10.
How about that? Not ranked and jumping in there like that.
But last Sunday, putting that vote in, the ballot going in, that was crazy, trying to figure out the top 25. And I think there was as much confusion about the top 25.
Who are you voting
number
one?
I have USC at number one.
Do you expect three or four of those teams that are in the top 10 right now to finish in the top 10?
I think we're going to see a lot of shuffling here over the next few weeks, because we're just now getting into the meat of the schedule.
Right. I mean, preseason polls, early season polls exist to create hype. They're not going to go away. You can debate it all you like. They're not going to go anywhere, but they don't mean a lot.
Yeah. I don't want them to go away. It's fun, man. That's passion. It's college football.
But you vote on the body of work, not reputation.
That's a losing battle, Mr. There's a big difference of opinion about what the pollsters think of South Carolina coming in. Coaches have them at 18. Writers at 11.
Big discrepancy.
And once again, Smelly pressured and sacked. They are all over the Gamecocks quarterback right now. That's Jeremy Jarvin, the leading sacker coming in, number 5 on the season, helped out by Corey Peters.
If there was a weakness that Kentucky was wanting, was to go after the offensive line of South Carolina. Kind of heavy feet. Don't really move very well, do they?
They've done a great job of getting pressure here in the second half, and you're right. We were talking before the game about that. And I was getting ready to say the thing Smelly has done is not turned it over. That ball almost did come out.
Another three and out forced by the Cats defense. The rugby punt, effective punt. It's a little still back there. No opportunity to redeem himself for the fumbles. The ball rolls out of bounds at the 19, 47 yards. Suck up very effective with that one step to the right rugby punt. And Woodson back on the job.
Let's go back to that thought you had there. South Carolina in the coaches poll, they're at number 11 in the AP.
Yeah.
All right? They're number 18 in the coaches poll. And Coach Spurrier said, it's kind of interesting, how these coaches got us a little bit lower.
Yeah, and do you think there's a bias against him amongst the coaches who vote?
I would imagine the old ball coach runs a few scores and he gets a few licks in the ballots.
All right. So there's a conspiracy to vote him down in the coaches poll. Complete. Dickie Lyons spins over the 30 for a first down. You're buying into the conspiracy theory.
If you don't think it, then you're being naive, because Steve Spurrier, he's put the woodshed on a lot of teams out there. And if you don't think that those coaches have great memories, then you're fooling yourself. You're kidding yourself.
I think there's probably a lot of coaches who aren't that fond of him, but I think there are also a lot of coaches that try to do the best they can when they vote their ballot. Why is this just a one-week phenomenon? They've never really seemed to vote him down in the past.
I know. I think this was a week, though, where there was a lot of confusion and doubt as to what was going on in the polls. So maybe there was a little bit of uncertainty there with the coaches.
They didn't feel obligated this week to vote him up there.
Well, you talk about
if he wins
perception.
A few more SEC games, then they'll feel obligated and they'll go ahead and do it.
But there, you said a confusion. There's a lot of confusion.
Oh, right, yeah. Now, there's got to be three or four teams that within 2 weeks are going to be back out of that top 10.
Like Oregon. I moved Oregon up. They lose at home, close, but I moved them up.
They moved on a play where he's reaching for the goal line. They're half a yard away from winning.
Good team.
It's a 50-50 game against a team that's ranked third in the poll, Cal. And Oregon did plummet. I think some teams are clearly penalized more than others by losing a game. Florida didn't get penalized that much by losing at home to Auburn. If they can beat LSU, upset them on the road, they'll be right back where they were.
And I kept LSU at number one because they played lousy, sloppy, and all that stuff. But they were against a Pac-10 opponent. They won the game. LSU, they messed around with Tulane third quarter.
That's all right. We got Gut Check Saturday coming up, buddy.
There's Gerard Sinclair, the backup linebacker, helped off the field. So Woodson back to work, down by 11. Tony Dixon is in the ballgame. Whose leg apparently okay that Aaron was telling us about. He's out in the pattern right up the middle. Woodson pressured, finds or tries to find Dixon, but bounced the throw. Casper Brinkley was pressuring.
He's trying to make the effort to get that ball out and get either the incompletion or the short completion, and he's risking that fumble there. There, you know, he got away with it. That's fine.
There's his brother, Jasper, watching. He's the more vocal leader of the two twins. Casper, a quieter personality. On second and 10, Dixon squirts away. Looked like he was going to get stopped for a loss. A flag comes in now. And it's another hold. Both offensive lines are struggling now. And there is how Jasper Brinkley, the only preseason All-SEC guy on this entire football team, injuring himself. They tried to wrap up. Now you see the knee going against LSU. They tried to wrap that knee. That's a torn ligament. And he was going to try to go in there and
play. He went back in. Obviously couldn't go and came right back out. But
back to keep his cast and
it's the new
dry.
Look.
Well, you got to
stay. That's the new
dry.
Look.
And his brother says it almost can guarantee he'll come back next year if the NCAA grants him the eligibility. You can do that when you get an injury early in a season. Second and forever. Woodson flips it off short. Nice job fighting loose for Little. Daniel Cook dragging him down. Check it, that's Dixon.
You know, this offense is playing in a tight box right now. And I, if you know, get your opinion on this thing here, Doug. I wouldn't be opposed if I were Joker Phillips to telling Woodson, take off every once in a while. Add that element of defense.
You know, the element you're looking for is to stretch the field, but every time he's gone deep, South Carolina's defense has been there and made the play and been soft, so you're right. Maybe move around a little more and use your legs.
That's only 2 of 6 on third down. Dixon dropped way short of the first down. Emmanuel Cook right there.
Again, he had nothing downfield. It was third and long, soft coverage, bail it out, make them dump it off, and they've got a punt. And that's all down and distance.
We see it time and time again on Saturday. Quarterbacks in college football, when they take off and run, have big gains. If he'll just do it once or twice, he's going to force them on defense to put an eye and a spy on him and cover him.
Well, you have to get away from the holding penalty, the bad down and distance, the negative play. If you can stay in good down and distance, absolutely.
The dangerous Captain Munnerlyn back to receive the punt. Makes it in traffic, hit immediately. And a Cole Frey drop at the 25. So, South Carolina's defense does the job. After the 41-yard punt, they'll take over, up 11. The Louisville Redbirds came back to stick the Razorback Hogs, and no problem with the burrowing Owls. Trail the Gamecocks tonight and ahead the dangerous species in the SEC, the really dangerous ones, the Tigers of LSU and the Gators visiting Lexington the next couple of games.
You see the boots on the back of that alligator?
Gators fascinate me. That's awesome.
Oh, man.
That is awesome.
I got three on a ranch on our lake that we fish, and I will never get out of the boat.
How large are the Gators?
About 8 feet long. Bigger than us.
Corey Boyd with the carry.
I take a little wave runner through the canals in Florida, and there's some big ones, about 10 to 12 footers out there.
on a
wave runner.
See, dude?
Oh, yeah.
Wave runner?
Little wave runner.
You better not be doing too many 360s on that.
Yeah, don't fall off.
Wave runners are, you kind of sit down and ride them. There's not much you can do wrong to turn them over. They're fun, but they're not.
You know, he doesn't like the feet down near the water.
No, you could do it, James. There's no skill involved. Hasn't been a very productive second half with this Gamecock offense. Negative 17 yards in the seven plays, and Boyd not going very far in this one. It'll be third and long again. Breyer on the stop.
Trying to run the ball and hammer it out a little bit, keep yourself in down the distance, but they're not getting enough out of these runs.
Yeah, but you're seeing a lot of crossing. There's a movement that's going on inside. See that little top there to the left of your screen? You see the cross stunts? They're putting pressure now up front, finally tonight, Kentucky's defensive line.
See if they can protect Smelly on third and six. The rush has been fierce for the Cats lately. Kinley's in the slot. Smelly looks high and throws incomplete. He's trying to get Freddie Brown on the slant.
So we got three and outs.
Yeah, and I told you that Kentucky almost never forces three and outs.
So what is the percentage on three in a row?
Go back to that isometric.
This is the first.
Whatever,
I guarantee it's the first time this year they've had three straight three and outs.
What's that isometric list? Are you
guys? Esoteric.
Okay. Send me a note, sweetheart, this week.
Teach you a new one.
Esoteric.
You got to tell me when it's a big word, because that's not that big a deal. You tell me when you think it's a big word.
I love
football players over here, all right? All right.
Former.
Suck up to boot it away. And Little looks it into his hands this time, not taking any chances after the fumble earlier in the quarter. Fair catch at the 30. 40-yard punt. You see Rod Sinclair going off to the locker room. He was injured. Top 10 losses last week. Shake up Saturday. Buffalo's got him at home over the Sooners. Big comeback. Florida stunned in the swamp. First home loss for Meyer. West Virginia, a whole bunch of mistakes and turnovers. Great game by USF. And Colt McCoy knocked around. Had four interceptions against Kansas State. Greg Schiano's defense not playing well as Maryland rallied from behind to win by 10 on the road. Woodson, first down throw, it's complete. And collecting it for a short gain is Steve Johnson.
I think of all of those losses, the Colorado over Oklahoma, that surprised me big time.
Yeah, Oklahoma really was not dominating the game. They had a couple of touchdown drives with a short field after interceptions. Buffalo's defense remarkably effective, and they ran the ball well on the Sooners. Burton trying to shake free, and he does. Keenan Burton into Gamecock territory. Dropped at the 45. Chased down by Norwood from behind after a 15-yard gain.
There's that Norwood again. You talk about hustle and effort. This guy never gives up. This is how you play football. To the whistle. How about that?
He almost strips the ball. He reaches for the strip and almost got it.
Special player enjoying a career night, too. Touchdowns for the Gamecock sophomore defensive end. First down at the 46.
There's that three down line again, Chris.
And they run it to the boundary. Little hurdles a man and scoots down near the first down marker. Hammered out of bounds there by Rodney Polk and Melvin Ingram.
Well, when we spoke with Mr. Norwood, we're going to call him Mr. Norwood yesterday, his intensity and focus led us to believe he was ready to play football. He hadn't let us down tonight, has he? All over the field.
There's the first quarter fumble, athletic scoop and a touchdown. And here he is collecting that lateral, and he ran it 53 yards for a score. This is Little getting a first down inside the 35.
Don't lose track. I mean, Kentucky here is gaining some momentum. Ole Miss starting to slide over there. They've got three and outs. They drove down the field with a nice drive. Only came away with a field goal. But here they go again. And it's methodical. It's not these big, exciting plays right now, though.
They have not had a lot of big games at all. And traffic in Clobbered incomplete. Emmanuel Cook sniffed it out, came up and hammered Burton.
And again, I talk about playing in a tight box right now. Kentucky, maybe they feel like there's a lot of pressure up front, you know?
The strength of this defense is the secondary, though, and they're hitting, they're covering receivers. There's nothing open up the field right now.
Brooks thought that Cook hit him a little too early.
He's saying, block him. You know, there's a guy responsible for that man out there covering him. Block him.
Woodson on the roll, fires high, caught by Burton. And fights for about seven. It'll be third and short.
This is all he has available to him are these quick hitches, the little wide receiver screens to the back. Anything up the field is being covered like a blanket, so he's... To do this, you have to march the ball 10, 12, 15 plays to stick it in the end zone.
No completions longer than 25 yards, and they're averaging about 10 yards per completion tonight. Third and three. Little as a first down. Run out of the 20. An important conversion. Thomas forcing him out. Little over 100 yards tonight.
Not so sure that they wouldn't have gone for it there anyway. You know, keep the momentum while they have it. Keep that South Carolina offense on the sideline.
Moot point now. First down. Little 117 yards. They're in the red zone again. You can see the total domination in this quarter by the Wildcats. Hancock offense in red numbers. It's Tony Dixon. Change of pace back in the ballgame now. He's got it. Norwood again on a stop off the edge.
Again, go back. Going into this football game in the red zone, Kentucky extremely good at scoring touchdowns. 23 out of 24 times they had gone into the red zone and scored, and 12 of those 20 were by the rush. So this is a team that will run it. They're patient when they get in there. And tonight they've done all right down there.
Now they did have the interception, though, down in the red zone by Munnerlin. Dixon again, has a blocker, gets inside the 10, first and goal Wildcats.
Tony Dixon from Kentucky on the carry.
Christian Johnson is a backup offensive lineman, got out there, and Tammy throwing blocks as well. Pretty simple play.
Did you see that block on the corner there on Brinkley? The tight end, Tammy, he just body control and gave the running back the corner.
I got to believe Woodson's doing a great job of getting him in the correct running play, making the right audibles to run away from pressure or from a numbers standpoint to the correct side. Could be checking to a pass here.
South Carolina students right in his face making noise. Woodson on first down, throws in the vicinity a little bit. Once again, the dangerous Mr. Norwood was in the neighborhood.
Great job of peeling off with the back on his responsibility. It looked like they were going to come with a blitz. He checks to a pass, and Norwood, I assume it's his responsibility, peels off with the back as he's releasing.
You know what, I check where number 40 is, everybody. I would just check for him.
Good point.
That'd be my first check.
Yeah, he would be to the wide side of the field at this point.
Tights and they try power to the boundary again. Some blockers out there, but a good job fighting off the corner to make the play was Cody Wells, the backup linebacker.
Sager came up and he just ran right through the legs, and it's a good call. I thought he had a chance to get around the corner.
It looked like he was going to score. That was a great open field tackle.
Seconds of the third quarter.
There's that Jacob Tammy out here in the slot, Chris, a big 6'5 receiver.
Fumble on the handoff. They collect it at the 5. Raphael Little. Eyes up looking at the end zone, didn't get the exchange from Woodson. They dodged what would have been a disastrous turnover, but they'll have to settle for field goal attempts.
Boy, it looked like he was going to walk in the end zone.
And you know, you said over here, you looked at me, you said quarterback draw. You know, your body language and all, which was a good idea. That was going to accomplish the same thing.
Maybe they saw it too, got a little eager. So Norwood and the defense keeps the Wildcats out of the end zone. They'll run the other way for the final 15 minutes with South Carolina up 24-13. And it's been a fun night. Not a good night for the body paint to stay on, but then again, body paint should be outlawed in my mind.
Well, you got to be careful, because if you have waterproof body paint, then it's body paint.
Kentucky has rallied twice.
What?
In Arkansas. This is Siever trying to make it 3 for 3 on the night at the 23-yarder. And he knocks it through.
Well, they get 3, but they had 7. I mean, this was just a botch. When you look at the hole, no question, little. Oh, look at the room. You'd think, I think an old guy could get through on that one.
One of us, I'd get halfway and hand it to you, and you try to finish it.
Well, we'd both pull our hamstrings getting there, but we'd get there.
South Carolina had been blitzing just before that. There they went to a zone look. So in the audible situation, he goes to the run, makes the right call, gets him in the right play. They mishandle the handoff.
And Little has struggled. He had the fumble punt earlier, and now the handoff that cost him 4 points. And how about this in the third quarter? South Carolina trails by 7.5 to.
Smoke and mirrors, baby. Work it. That shot that our producer, yeah. Director gave us,
was really of the older gentleman that was going to score if he'd had the football. That was what we were trying to get.
Oh, okay. All right.
All right. He just didn't want to give you, throw you a curveball there.
Would he have gotten in? Oh, if you're on your knees, though, you're down.
Yeah, see the ribbon in the hair there?
No, see, I'm blind.
Yeah, come on.
If she wasn't touching, it was the NFL, you could call in, right?
I'm sorry, yeah.
Pebbles.
Yeah, NFL, she would have gotten in.
Oh, man. We'll see if the Carolina offense can turn things around after the back-to-back-to-back 3 and outs. It's not Munnerlin, but one of the upbacks gets a nice return out across the 35. Melvin Ingram. Saturday night, unbeaten Ohio State, unbeaten Purdue and West Lafayette, Pac-10 markets, and some folks in Indiana will see Notre Dame try for their first win. They're one of the winless teams in 1A against UCLA, also available on ESPN Game Plan, part of Gut Check Saturday. We're going to learn a lot about the Boilermakers in this one. And perhaps Ohio State, too. I'm not sure the Buckeyes in another year would be ranked number 4 in the country.
Longest wide receiver, Brian Robiski, keeps going up for the ball at Ohio State like he is. Beckman will continue to be good.
Mike Davis, as they try to protect this 8-point lead, and make something positive happen on offense in the second half.
Boy, they have really gone cold up front. South Carolina's offensive line, as well as they did in the first half, they've reversed field here in the second.
They've really gone to just running the ball strictly on first and second down and then figuring out what they got and trying to convert.
Crowd out of the game, haven't they been here for the third quarter? Nothing to cheer about?
Not much, no, other than the fumble return for a touchdown by Norwood to start this third quarter. Smelly fires back to a wide open receiver. Tight end Jared Cook got loose inside the 40. Marcus McClinton drove him out 20 yards. They've used the tight ends effectively tonight.
This is a sophomore, and his reception numbers are really coming on lately. Gets confused, lost there in the shuffle coming across the field.
Very similar route to what he broke early in the game and got stripped from behind.
That was Saunders, another young tight end, but you're right, it was a similar looking play. First down at the 41. It back. Tries to get the corner and haul down at the 35. No fumble. Let's go back to Reese Davis for a 30 at 30 update. Reese.
All right, Chris, the Yankees have fallen into a 1-0 hole against Cleveland. Victor Martinez, a two-run job, as the Tribe pounded out 14 hits and destroyed the Yankees 12-3 to take a 1-0 lead in their division series. Marion Jones, the track legend, has acknowledged that she used steroids before the 2000 Olympics. She will plead guilty in federal court to 2 counts of lying to a federal agent. SportsCenter after the game, State Current, ESPN News.
Maurice, thanks. Second and six. McKinley motions into the slot. A flag is down as Davis bangs into the secondary and falls inside the 25. Tough to tackle. Now we'll check the flag, which was back in the backfield. And a South Carolina lineman appears to be down. He'll be helped to his feet. That was William Brown. Walking gingerly.
Maybe their best player up front, too.
And this one's coming back.
Illegal shift on the offense. The wideout came in motion. The far wideout stepped up. They never got set. 5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
It was McKinley motioning in.
If two people are moving at the same time, they both have to get set before the ball is snapped.
Speaking of McKinley, it's the first time you said his name. You know, talk about a player, a playmaker, the playmaker on this offense.
It's been a while.
Had the 4 catches in the first half. We weren't calling anybody's name in the third quarter because they were going backwards steadily.
And extending their lead.
Henley sets him up at 2nd and 11. Gets him down 8. Hands the ball back. Melle pressured up the middle, gets rid of it on time. It's caught out of the backfield. Was Boyd making the catch and inside the 25. That's one way to beat the pressure.
Boyd lucked out on this. He blew right by. He assumed his guy was going to cover him. Instead, he blows right by him. Now the ball's got to be hot and thrown. He runs by the other defender and makes the play.
Now Woodyard just getting there late. 16-yard gain.
Well, of course, you know, if he really knew what he was talking about, though, he did the right thing because that linebacker was supposed to come out of there because he would have known as a running back pre-snap.
Called zone blitzes.
After you got a hand, you better make sure you peel out linebacker.
Davis on first down. Has a crease and barrels down in the 15.
There's that crowd.
Freddie Brown, the receiver, down on the field as the medical crew comes out to take a look at him. This is really how, when they've beaten the big boys in the SEC the last couple of years, this is how Spurrier's teams have done it. It hasn't always been pretty or spectacular or emphatic. Haven't been a bunch of dazzling offensive plays. You go to Georgia, win a 16-12 game, and here, you know, two defensive touchdowns. The offense has one touchdown, and Kentucky has the big edge in yards, but it's Spurrier up by 8 and driving early in the fourth quarter. An SEC title. Kentucky hasn't had a piece of one in 31 years since 76. And it's Mike Davis barreling ahead. It's an effective drive. They've now marched more than 50 yards on this drive after moving backwards. Negative 15 total offense in the third quarter.
So those guys right there, them big uglies, them big guys, they're leaning on them now. Heavy feet, those heavy-footed guys.
Leaning on the running game.
Yep, they're getting after it now.
Boy, they love to run the football up front.
This is Stafford, the fullback, in front of Davis. It is Davis. Crease and a good tackle there. Johnson, and by the leg, wouldn't let go.
Well, Steve Spurrier said to Aaron Andrews going into halftime, we're going to run the football a little bit more in the second half. He's a man of his word.
He tried to in the third quarter, couldn't get it done, but they're getting it done here in the fourth. They had to wait for the fourth. They took the third quarter off. They just rested.
They sure did. And Kentucky could not capitalize. Second and goal. They fake it to Davis. Smelly. Fires. Complete. Touchdown. Spurrier's offense awakens. And the first touchdown, just the third catch of the season for the nephew of the golfer, Chris DeMarco, the true freshman. Altamont Springs, Florida. And now, review it. See if DeMarco got the foot down. They've been very cautious, this crew. They reviewed everything, even if it didn't look to be a close call.
Got to get it right. How about that fullback, though, getting lost in play action? Linebacker even tries to hold him. Woodyard, look at him holding.
They set this up with the play before. Same formation.
Touchdown.
Same formation. They had the tight end over strong side. So it was kind of an unbalanced look, and they ran the ball weak. Now they go play action. Same exact look.
Another young player on this football team, a freshman. Steve Spurrier just continues to build, getting the athletes in here.
Most of the freshmen have seen playing time. The true freshmen are on the defensive side. There are some talented freshmen being redshirted. DeMarco, Deion LeCorn, the receiver, some of the true freshmen seeing action. Smelly is a redshirt freshman. Future looks pretty good.
Exactly.
Overrated.
Yeah, here comes the most famous chant in college football. Most overused, perhaps, too.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. It was a touchdown.
In the first half, McKinley trying to find the ball in that corner. Tipped. Another close call, and this is in that very same corner. The freshman going up and getting it.
Somebody told the ball coach that it doesn't count unless you're near that pylon.
Suck up, knocks it through. A flag on this conversion. Hold on. Conference here. Assuming the conversion stands, this will be the big lead of the night for the Gamecocks, stretching it to 15. All right, fellas.
We're going to review this.
Offsides, number 34 on the defense. Penalty is declined. The point is good.
Thank you. After all that. And the Kentucky faithful, this is a test of faith. They did come back against Louisville, came back at Arkansas, but Smelly and company up by 15 now. Here in Columbia, the rain has moved on. Wildcats faithful watching their team try to do it one more time. This has been the MO, but this feels like a deep hole. Woodson just not having a big night. They haven't had any big plays, really. At the goal line, gets some nice blocking up front, and he's knocked down at the 27-yard line. Smelly 3 of 3 on that last drive. 8 plays, 62 yards. Here's a look at Woodson's night.
Well, he's had a rough night. He has not been comfortable in the pocket all night. It started out early, getting hit. Throwing the ball over, really didn't read the coverage right, and then the lateral, trying to get rid of it. Norwood picks it up, goes in and scores. But you know what? There's still a lot of time in this game, and Woodson's done this before.
He's been in this position. You got to have confidence now from the past.
See if Little can make something happen. Moves ahead for 8 yards. Again, they just haven't been able to create much downfield at all. No plays are longer than 25 yards.
Second half, how many first down big runs have we seen by Kentucky? And then they can't make and push that ball down the field.
Little again. Gets away, gets across the 40 and run out after making a first down. Kentucky bench wanted a flag for the tackle by Polk and Ingram. Don't get it.
Kentucky still coming out and showing patience here, trying to run the football. 10 minutes on the clock. You need 2 touchdowns.
And they had the 3 touchdowns in the last 8 minutes at Arkansas, while their defense played well, getting them back in the game.
Young man there, Burton. Got to get him involved.
Dixon is the back behind Woodson. Looks to the sidelines. One adjustment. They run the play clock. Woodson steps up, fires downfield, looking for Burton and the big play. Can't come up with it. Defended by Carlos Thomas. Had his hands on the football.
Made a great adjustment in the air to the ball. Came back a little bit underthrown, gave his receiver a chance, and Burton went up after. Had an opportunity to come down with it. Good coverage on the play, but a better job by Burton going up after the ball.
He's, you know, we talked about this at halftime. Receiver gets his hands on the ball. Be strong with the hands, make the catch. Fowler, you're hard on receivers. You say that's a catch, you'll be right.
I think receiver play is so underrated. That's the kind of thing that decides games right there. Woodson patiently waiting for his man to break open, and the flag flies, and that was again Thomas defending on Burton. Tripped him up.
Got to go to him. You got to put the pressure on your go-to receiver to go up and make plays, especially if we're going to give you some single out there.
Yeah, Thomas, that's a good penalty for Thomas to take. It was an out and up or a hitch and go, double move type of thing. He was beat, grabbed the receiver, and just said, hey, I'll take the flag instead of the touchdown.
Methodical crew, I'll say that.
Holding, number five on the defense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
And move the ball into South Carolina territory. Good penalty for Thomas, though, you said.
I think so.
Long completion.
You know, the ball was up in the air a little early, had to anticipate the throw, so he might have missed them, but for sure Burton was going by him.
That tells you a lot, doesn't it? 51 yards and 14 points.
Now they had the defensive touchdown. Kentucky just the two field goals. Little. Oh, Chuck Dixon on the delay. Dixon, first down. For Emmanuel Cook, he's been active tonight at safety with the stop at 11 yards.
I like the patience. Clock stops, move the chains, get to the line of scrimmage, make a call.
Yeah, they're running it, but it's an up-tempo offense.
Absolutely. Hey, and at 8 and 10 yards, a clip on first down rushes, what the heck?
Well, South Carolina's playing a two-deep zone, and they're playing more pass coverage, so they're staying with the run and gaining good yards.
Take it to Dixon. Woodson. No chance to go downfield before Cat Brinkley got him.
The two ends on this South Carolina defense are tenacious. They play beyond the 3 seconds. That internal clock, Doug, that you guys have at quarterback, it went off. He didn't get rid of the ball.
Yeah, that ball's got to go at some point. And chances are, because again, I said they were playing coverage, a two-deep zone, the only opportunity was the little dump off in front of them, if that.
Second and 19. They flip it short, Burton in traffic. Burton navigating down inside the 35. Sets up a makeable third down attempt, 14 yards on the play.
Even if it's not third down that they make it, you go ahead and pick up two or three or four here, you're going for it on fourth down.
Yep.
So it's a nice job of managing and not trying to hit the home run ball.
We need six. Dixon for a loss. Now it's fourth and long.
Literally right up the gut. Cook comes, times it out late. Hey, QB, you got to be quicker on that circle and the clip.
Here's a guy that had his appendix out and came back and played 2 weeks later at Georgia. Cook is a tough guy. And this will be a tough fourth down to convert. Fourth and eight. Woodson firing and tight roping on the sidelines is Steve Johnson for a first down. Munderman on the coverage, but the cushion a little bit too big.
How'd you like that?
Good throw?
Was that a throw?
Huge conversion. He has help over the top, so he doesn't have to give this much ground. He has a safety behind him, loses track of where the receiver is. Nice job sitting down on the sideline.
It puts that arm on display for the scouts who are here tonight. Needed eight, got nine. Crucial conversion inside 7.5 to play. Pump fake, throws into the end zone for Burton. Goes up, almost made the catch, had a chance on the carom. And it's Anderson Williams, the backup corner, was defending.
That is outstanding coverage because it's a little bit of a hitch in his giddy up, and then he's going, and South Carolina secondary buying none of it.
But Burton, no, in his mind, I'm going to catch this ball. He kept it to, they had one more shot down on the ground.
Left
great
side
focus.
Of it, I think, there, yeah.
That's a freshman. That's a pretty good football player back there.
This was the number one pass defense in the country coming in. Woodson flips it off short. Dixon has some room, gets the 20, run out inside the 15. It's a first down.
It feels like this drive's taking a long time, but it's only been about 3 minutes off the clock.
3:51 to be exact.
Okay, about four.
And it's absolutely crucial as the drive wears on. They must get a touchdown out of this possession.
Absolutely. Finish this one off. The last two times they've settled for field goals.
Dixon out and Raphael Little back in the game. But off short again. Little has it. Stiff arm out at the six.
All right. There's a little coaching strategy for you there. Joker Phillips, offensive coordinator. We've had pressure up the middle the last time. Let's go ahead and get something out quick on the side, right?
Little slam on the guy, release. That's a nice little play right
Eric
there.
Scott, the center, did a good job picking up the safety blitz coming up the middle.
Yeah,
guy.
Yeah. But get away from the middle pressure that stopped you on the last third down.
From the six, Little is the setback. Woodson goes for the end zone, caught for a touchdown. Coming back to make the catch was Steve Johnson. So they beat Munderland with a 6-yard touchdown following up on that 4th-and-8 conversion.
Little back shoulder throw here. Little stop the receiver with the ball, throw behind, stop, put the brakes on. See ya. Impossible to defend.
5th touchdown catch on the season for the guy who beat Louisville. That inexplicable blown coverage by the Cardinals. It was Johnson who hauled in the pass and scored the winning touchdown to kind of get the season rolling for the Wildcats. Johnson caught that 4th down play and the touchdown. So the conversion from Sieber. And this thing is cut right back now to an 8-point lead. So a 1-possession game. And Spurrier's offense back on the field with 6:59 to play. Can the Cats make it another comeback? This is a win over Georgia last year. A monumental victory. Look out, folks. And win it on their home field. And of course, it's added to some of the other comebacks last year, and then the game we talked about against Louisville.
Well, this one here, you're talking about a big lift for Kentucky and a dagger to Louisville. Aaron, I bet that bench over there at Kentucky kind of livened up a little bit after that touchdown.
See the comeback Craig, there against Arkansas. Go ahead, EA.
Sorry, Chris. Craig, it has. And, you know, when we had a chance to speak with Andre Woodson this week, we asked him, what is it about the fourth quarter comebacks? And he says, we just have this swagger. We have this confidence. We believe in ourselves. And Woodson made no bones about it how important this game was for the program. He told us for the very first time, people are now talking about Kentucky football, not just basketball, but football. And he said he was so happy for the seniors because for the longest time, just the parents of the football players were supporting them. Now everybody in Lexington is.
So it was usually all about basketball this time of year in Kentucky. Midnight Madness for the Hoopsters is this Friday, but now people know who they are on campus. And for better or worse, they know who you are. If you come home with a loss, they're going to know who you are, too.
Well, when you get in the top 10, they are used to it being something that you shoot up and try to make in the hoop.
And the kickoff is relatively short. Taken by an up man. Once again, that's Melvin Ingram hammered across the 30. And we'll see if the Gamecock offense can chew some clock, protect this 8-point lead. Of course, the tradition slightly richer.
Just a little.
Hardwoods there. 43 SEC titles in the 7 national championships. They got what was called a Sagarin national title retroactively from 1950, the Paul Bryan SEC championship team.
Kind of like that SMU championship that he keeps claiming over
okay,
here.
Okay, let's get back to the game here.
Okay.
There has to be a launching point somewhere, right? There's the coach.
Billy Gillespie. A lot of excitement in Lexington about this basketball team, and they'll get after it again. Practice this Friday before the LSU game. Davis. Tailback in the I formation. They try to play some power football. Davis just met at the line of scrimmage. No push up front at all.
Well, I tell you, if I'm on defense right now at Kentucky, I know who I'm looking for, Doug. It's going to be that tight end that's been lost twice on crossing routes on play action, right?
Well, they keep flipping him over, and it's kind of an unbalanced set right now. They're going to try to sneak him out somewhere.
Well, I just, you know. This didn't bleed the clock when there's 6.5 to go. You gotta keep the ball.
Especially with the history of Kentucky coming back. You know you have to go down the field, control the clock, and score.
And we'll see how much he trusts Chris Smelly to make a pressure throw in this situation. Throw it on second down. Smelly fires over the middle. It's caught and breaking away. Deion LeCorn, the freshman. Huge play, high percentage throw, and the true freshman trusted with the football there. Williams ran him out.
Yeah, that's why, they're going to throw the ball. Spurrier just feels it. He knows there's not going to be another three and out series here. That's the last thing he needs to do.
24-yard gain. Inside the 45 of the Wildcats. Any kind of points on this drive would be big trouble for Kentucky. Down 8. Doesn't go out of bounds, stays inside the 40. Coming up on SportsCenter after the game, Stuart Scott, John Buchegrass, get you caught up in the world of baseball, post-game coverage of this game here. Pep talk to the Gators. The Yankees go down on beloved Rock Pile. Up in Sioux Zip on the Phillies.
Hey.
National Divisional Series.
Go check Saturday, though. Where's game day this week?
Baton Rouge.
Baton Rouge.
Baton Rouge for Florida and LSU.
Think Tebow will be able to handle all that LSU defensive pressure they put on the quarterbacks?
Better get some help. The guys up front and the playmakers. Second and 5. Short gain off the left side for Boyd. Talked about game day from Baton Rouge for the second time this season. Kansas State's unbreakable bond. It's an Army unit that is serving overseas. That's a tremendous story. Danny Woodhead about to break the all-division yardage record. Shadron State in the northwest corner of Nebraska. And let's talk about the Gators coming together after last year's loss to Auburn. They'll need to do the same this week. Big 3rd and 3 for the Gamecocks. Boyd is the setback. Smelly in the shotgun. And with 2 seconds on the play clock, the redshirt freshman looks over and takes a timeout. 3rd and 3. Spurrier's had a long time during this timeout to look at Kentucky's defensive formations, make adjustments. It's McKinley motioning into the slot. Smelly rolls that way, fires, caught. And it is McKinley with a first down, skipping out at the 30. That a factor there? He took a long, long, long look at Kentucky's defensive formation. They stood over the ball on offense for about 1.5 minutes there.
That's what you said. We're in the break watching it, and they get him out there quick. And the old ball coach, he knows how to get a ledge.
He got to a great play. He rolled out to avoid any protection problems. And it was also a throw that can come out quickly, so he wouldn't take a sack, and it's a safe throw over by the sideline.
And McKinley, the last thing that Kentucky wanted was him on a post down the middle of the field.
When you're one-on-one, you stay inside technique and avoid the big play.
By the way, that's the first 3rd down they've converted this half. Huge one. Now they go back to running Boyd. It's about four.
Well, the pressure of staying in the top 10 continues, right?
It has not been a typical, you know, Kentucky performance. Lots of mistakes. Woodson, known for not throwing interceptions, threw a crucial one, a couple of fumbles. The decision he made to throw the ball, which was a lateral return for a touchdown by Norwood. That's a mistake they had not been making this season.
It's the SEC and it's on the road. You know, and I know that people say, well, they haven't done great against teams at home and top-ranked teams, but part of the formula.
Boyd in the flat, has it, and has the corner. Corey Boyd, racing for the end zone, touchdown! This Gamecock offense so unimpressive in the third quarter has answered with a couple of touchdowns here in the fourth. Corey Boyd, his first touchdown reception of the season. Got a nice block from Andy Boyd, the tight end, no relation. And Kentucky in deep, deep trouble. It'll take a true blue miracle to get out of Columbia at 6-0. Suck up for the conversion. What a job on that drive.
Just managing the game down a distance-wise, clock, running it down, and finishing off with a score.
Number 8, and a whole lot of trouble in the final 3.5 minutes. How about them Gamecocks, as the Kentucky Blue fans are feeling that way as they file out of Williams-Brice, and the sobering thought for the Wildcats as they apparently are on their way to the first loss of the season is that at 5-1, here comes LSU in Florida the next couple of weeks to Lexington.
Where are they going? They got a Heisman candidate at quarterback.
Exactly. That's what I'm thinking.
They know the comeback history, and they're going to beat the traffic. Block. Trying to make something happen on special teams. Hammered at the 27. South Carolina, meanwhile, if they can hold this 15-point lead in the final 3:21, will move to 5-1, step out of conference against Butch Davis's struggling Tar Heels a week from Saturday, have a home game with Vanderbilt, should be 7-1 heading to Rocky Top.
This Tennessee clash here.
Beat them 2 years ago. It was the first ever win by South Carolina on Rocky Top. Florida comes in here with a fairly entertaining matchup later on. Woodson has plenty of time, lofts it too high. Johnson not able to come down with that one. Now they need to really look downfield, you think. They can't use the short passing.
He was trying there. He was trying to look the defender under the short guy and go up the field, and South Carolina didn't bite on it. Finally, he wheeled around.
Observation on that particular play right there, and he's had a couple of others. He didn't have the confidence to make that throw between the roll-up corner and the back safety.
They throw it short again, almost intercepted by Norwood, trying to add to his monster night. Hand on it. Man, are you telling me that he almost came up with a third defensive touchdown?
That would have topped it off.
Hey, the guys are losing their hats a lot tonight. It's Brinkley.
They must not make those snaps as good as they used to, because those helmets come off a lot.
What?
He started the play without him.
Woodson scrambling on third down, and he'll be sat down inside the 15 by Joel Reeves.
This young Tyrone Nix defense starting to show a little maturity out there. There are a lot of young players, and this is the kind of
pass answer.
looking good.
Thank goodness for the sliders.
That wouldn't seem to be evidence of a hold down there, huh?
Oh, shoot.
Fourth and 22, last chance.
You make the call.
Woodson pressured again, steps up, heaves it downfield. It's Burton on the sidelines, into double coverage, went up for the football, and couldn't come down with it. Stoney Woodson and Carlos Thomas, and they got no britches, but they got a big win coming their way.
A lot of pressure on that cotton backside there. Well, you know, this is just a matter of just mistiming it.
He did.
He's got to catch the ball.
About 5 yards earlier, Thomas grabbed a hold of him right there. He just saw the tail end of it.
And then Burton went up and mistimed his jump.
But don't you think that Burton would say, I'd like to see that again?
I'd like another shot at that one, yeah. No doubt.
Gamecocks take over. Ball is at the 15 of Kentucky. And a punching and insurance touchdown here. And Spurrier will apparently continue his mastery of Kentucky. Make it 15-0. 3-0 here at South Carolina. Davis. It's about a yard.
You know, at this point here, Norwood, Eric Norwood, at least for my vote, would be player of the game, right?
Absolutely.
But you'd have to give a tip of the cap to the South Carolina offensive line. We watched them on tape, and we were not overly impressed.
A little slow of foot.
Yep.
Sluggish.
They gave up 5 sacks, but in the fourth quarter, they were very, very large when it came to those 2 touchdown drives.
And Chris Smelly making no mistakes, no turnovers.
Davis flies inside the 10. It's gut check Saturday as we check our Applebee's weekend menu. The Red River Shootout, both limping in off the loss. You guys like Oklahoma in that game?
I like Oklahoma. I like Bradford. I think they rebound nicely.
I'm on that bandwagon there. I was shocked at their loss last week.
Your thoughts on the game in Baton Rouge?
I think LSU's defensive line, that front seven, they've demoralized almost every quarterback they've played. And Tebow,
is he going to have to carry the ball 25, 30 times against that D-line?
He'll be living in an ice bath next week if he does. Davis on 3rd and 4. Rise for the dagger. Boom! Slams into the DB, drives him to the ground. It'll be 1st and goal at the 3. This is a fun time for the offensive line, right? You get the big lead, you know, final minute. You're going to get the W, trying to add to it.
The question is, does Spurrier try to stick this? Obviously, he's trying to stick it in the end zone right now. There's 40 seconds left.
He's got a lot of reverse in his history.
Now, the players want to score a touchdown, too.
You saw him say congratulations there to Tyrone Nix. That defense played a heck of a game against this Kentucky offense.
Kentucky had 384, so a lot less than they've averaged. But the red zone defense stout for Nix's crew. Power football. Davis fighting, twisting, stopped at the 2. Not always easy to be a defensive coordinator for Steve Spurrier, but he shows his appreciation right here.
Coach Cooper upstairs, he did a nice job too for this defensive staff. They work together, and Spurrier's got to be pleased.
Spurrier out on the field. That's it. They won't snap it again. South Carolina deflates a 5-0 start and knocks off number 8. And Eric Norwood, a Wrangler player of the game. 2 fumble returns for a touchdown and a whole bunch of tackles.
He's smiling now, huh? He couldn't crack a smile the other day to save his life.
Great job, Eric. Congratulations to you, young man.
Smelly tonight in the fourth quarter, 102 yards passing and a couple of touchdowns, 6 of 6 for the redshirt freshman. So Kentucky knocked from the ranks of the unbeaten. South Carolina goes to 5-1 and stepped forward as a serious contender in the SEC East.